These are the schools of the Ivy League. Brown University, Columbia University, Cornell University, Dartmouth College, Harvard University, University of Pennsylvania, Princeton University, Yale University, and this is the Ivy League Football Game of the Week. This week, Dartmouth meets Yale at the Yale Bowl in New Haven, Connecticut.
The fans arrive early for games in the Ivy League with one thought in mind, to tailgate. But that's the way it is in the Ivy League. And no school is more suited to the pregame custom of tailgating than Yale. The parking lots and the fields surrounding the Yale Bowl are spacious, which enables the tailgaters to really do as they please, whether it be to erect a tent or just spread out a blanket. Tailgating, it is said, had its origin in the Ivy League. Whether that's fact or fiction, I don't know. Old grads, recent grads, and just plain fans all get caught up in this pregame enjoyment. The picnic basket, blankets spread out, pregame libations, outdoor grills, occasional song, and lots of merriment are the order of the day. It's a time for camaraderie, good-natured badgering between the partisans of Yale and Dartmouth today. And when the football game has been played and the bragging rights established for another year, this scene will carry on till darkness falls. And down in the parking lot among the merriment is our man, Sean McDonough.
Bill White, Dartmouth class of 70. Bill, what's on the menu here today?
Oh, we've got shrimp, filet mignon, some spinach dips, some Roquefort cheese, rolls, salad, you name it, we've got it. A little bit of wine, a little Bloody Marys, some beer, some champagne, and some Coke.
How often have you been coming to these games?
We try to come every time they play down here.
You live in the area?
We live up in the Simsbury area. Yep.
Who are you rooting for today?
Bulldog people.
Bulldog people?
Yeah.
How long have you been coming to these games?
Pardon me?
How long have you been coming to the game?
Oh, God.
10 years.
10 years?
15 years.
15 years.
What are you eating today?
Oh, you name it, we got it.
From soup to hot dogs, hamburgers, wine.
Peanuts.
Just about anything.
Anything you want.
Chocolate cake. We've got it.
Who are you rooting for today?
Well, the historic Yale Bowl as the crowd continues to file in for the 68th meeting between Yale and Dartmouth. A beautiful day for football. Hello, everybody. Dick Galiette along with Upton Bell. And we're really expecting a classic Ivy League encounter this afternoon because the records really don't mean anything in this one. 0-3 Dartmouth on the season, 0-1 in the Ivy League. Yale 1-2, but 0-1 in Ivy League play. Both coaches agree, Upton Bell, this is a pivotal game.
Well, it really is. That's why I have my hat on. It's pivotal. And this game is a pivotal game, actually more so for Dartmouth, I think, than Yale, even though the loser is probably out of the Ivy League race. But the real story of this game, Dick, happens to be injuries. Rich Wiseman, the fine tailback out of Dartmouth, was injured in the Holy Cross game last week and will not play today. And that is a great part of their offense. Now, the quarterback, Mike Carviello, is a very, very important factor now. More pressure is put on him because of the injury to Wiseman. Look for Dartmouth to throw the ball 30 times a game. Look for Yale to have to play excellent defense. In fact, they're getting a lot of their people back also. The key to Yale, can they move the ball well on the ground? Can they move it from the tailback position? Can Mike Curtin do a good job of mixing the run and the pass against a very big Dartmouth defense? I don't think so. I think Yale's favored, but I think Dartmouth might win the game.
We're looking for a thriller. That's no overstatement. Down on the sidelines, we'll be roaming there throughout the afternoon, Sean McDonough.
Thank you very much, Dick and Upton, and good afternoon, everybody. For the fourth straight Saturday on our Ivy League football game of the week, it is a beautiful day. The sun is shining brightly. There is a big crowd on hand here at the Yale Bowl, and they are enjoying temperatures between 65 and 70 degrees. Biggest factor in the playing conditions will be the wind. We are feeling the side effects of Hurricane Josephine, and it is really windy down here in the field, gusting up to about 20 miles per hour. So we'll keep our eye on the conditions, but for now, Bula Bula, let's play ball back upstairs.
Well, we're almost ready for football here in this classic encounter this afternoon, which will be between Yale and Dartmouth. There you see the Ivy League standings. Penn and Brown sit up at the top, undefeated so far in the season. Harvard and Princeton are next. Harvard, rather, with 1-0 record. Princeton 1-1. And then the rest of the league with Yale, Cornell, and Dartmouth at 0-1. And Columbia 0-2 on this young football season. But coaches agree, two losses in the Ivy League this year will not get you a piece of the title.
Let's take a look at some of the key players we'll be seeing on both sides of the field this afternoon. Yale, of course, will be directed by number 7, Mike Curtin. Now, he had off-season surgery during the summer. He recovered well, and he is the key to this attack. Mike Luzzi, the wingback, number 10, will be one of his favorite targets. Mike Curtin told us he just feels great about this game coming in. Rick Coase had 2 touchdowns a week ago. He can break it if he gets that blocking up front. That'll be a key today. Another one of the backs we'll be seeing will be number 35, Dave Klein. He's a converted tailback. Moved him to the fullback position. That'll be the Yale attack this afternoon for the most part.
I think one of the keys, too, on the other side of the field is Dartmouth and their quarterback, Mike Carviello, number 11. With the loss of Rich Wiseman, as we said in the pregame, Dick, I think he's going to have to play a lot better as we take a look at Dartmouth now. And their fine quarterback, we're taking a look at the crowd, but here is Dartmouth, here is Carviello, number 11, rolling to his left, and he is going to hit Scott Truitt, number 89, their best deep threat. You talk about deep threat, that's right in the end zone, and that's what he's going to have to do today with the lack of running. Even though Lorenzo Chambers and some of the other people that will take their place, we can take a look at Peter Quarterbine, number 94, who probably is their leading defensive player. They have other fine people, Scott Keogh and company, but Peter Quarterbine, number 64, is the key to their defense. Number 15, Don Pomeroy, is their co-captain, and really the guy back there that they look to intercept in key periods.
We'll be getting ready for the toss of the coin here at midfield, where we'll have the captains on both sides. Of course, the captains for Dartmouth, the visitors in their white uniforms with the green numerals, and Martin Martinson, 51, for Yale there. He's the center. He is the captain of the Elis. The Elis always have single captains. They've not had a co-captain. And on the far side of the field, Martinson will make his way to meet with Mike Carviello, number 11, for Dartmouth, and number 15, Don Pomeroy, a great outstanding player in the secondary for Dartmouth.
Captain Pomeroy and Captain Carviello.
How do you do, gentlemen?
This is Captain Martinson.
The referee is Donald Coburn.
And Captain Pomeroy.
Gentlemen, your other officials today, Mr. Kizio is your back judge. Mr. Lascitalia is your
today, Thomas
line
Tobin.
Judge. Mr. Pickett is your head linesman. Mr. Compton is your
field
judge.
Linesman will be Robert Pickett. And line Coleman judge Philip Lascitalia, and the field judge Thomas Compton, and the back judge James Egizio.
Who's going to call it? Michael. You're going to call it? Call in the air, please.
Tails,
and it is tails. Thomas wants a toss. You want the ball, okay? What goal are you defending?
North
goal. Move your backs that way, please. Move your backs this way. Thomas on the toss, and will receive. Gentlemen, shake hands. Good luck to you.
Dartmouth won the toss and has elected to receive.
And now down on the field, the Yale band with our national anthem.
Time to play ball.
Dartmouth has won the toss, so we'll be seeing Yale kick off. We'll be taking a look at the Dartmouth offense for the first time this afternoon. And Upton Bell, losing Rich Weissman is like losing 3 players. Leading rusher, leading pass receiver, leading kick returner. That's a big gap to fill.
Yeah, he led in all those fields as we watch the Yale team getting ready for their pep talk or whatever it is here in the huddle. But also, I think, on the other hand, that Yale has to be very careful because you lose a great player. I've seen it happen so many times. There's a tendency to maybe let down a little. But remember one thing about Dartmouth. If you look at their stats, they really spread the offense around a lot to the receivers, and they really have some fine receivers. I look for them to try to run the ball a lot in the beginning, but also throw as much as they can, particularly on the defense.
Well, Carm Koza, Yale's coach, had some comments before this game.
Bill Moore to kick for Yale.
Well, we know we have to stop their passing attack. Curviello's a fine thrower. We got beat in the last 40 seconds a year ago against this team, and we know they like to throw the football. They also keep you honest with the running game, and defensively, they're a senior team. I know they had a few people out early in the year, but we saw them in their game against Holy Cross last week, and they really have improved. So we think they're a very good Ivy League football team, and we're going to have to play our level best to win.
Even though it's still relatively early in the season, I know you've been quoted as saying that you feel this is a very important game for both clubs.
This is a pivotal game because if we can win, we're still in the Ivy hunt. And if they can win, they'll be in it. And I'm not real sure that two losses will give you a chance. It may, but it's going to be an outside chance.
And Dartmouth coach Joe Yukika on the sidelines. The deep men for Dartmouth awaiting the opening kickoff. Number 45 is Duax for Dartmouth. And number 35, Lorenzo Chambers, who will be filling in for the injured Rich Weissman. As you look at Mike Curtin, the Yale quarterback, number 7.
In fact, they'll be both the tailbacks today that they're going to have to count on to fill in for Weissman. Why not get them ready on the opening kickoff, right?
Bill Moore, number 3, does the kicking for Yale as the ball blows off the tee. That's probably going to happen a few times this afternoon with the wind blowing very briskly here in the bowl. The deep men, Lorenzo Chambers on the left, number 35, and Tim Duax on the right. The 68th meeting between Yale and Dartmouth is underway. Duax. And Duax brings it to the 29-yard line, where Dartmouth will have a first and 10 at their own 29. Tackle made by Carmen Alacqua, a key number 40 on the Yale defense this afternoon, returning with a broken hand. Number 40, and he's playing next to Ardell McKenna, number 56. The offensive line in the backfield for Dartmouth, Stevens, Chambers, True at the split end, and Caraviello the quarterback. There he is, Mike Caraviello, the senior out of Medford, Massachusetts. Yale almost pops offside, and I guess they do as the flag is dropped. A little anxious over there for the Elis. That's Mark Dellinger, number 79, who made the first move.
Also, Zanieski, who really is the key, their nose guard in this defense, is the guy you really want to watch. He's not very big. He's only 6 feet, maybe 219, but he's probably their quickest and strongest player.
The defensive lineup for Yale, the defensive end, Iacobucci, Maloney the tackle, the middle guard, Zanieski, right tackle, Dellinger, and the end, Kennan. The linebackers, Alacqua leading that charge, and Kakevich, Penders, and Jarkson in the backfield, in the secondary. It is first down and 5 from the 34. Chambers in motion. Rob Brown gets the first call of the game, and he is immediately stacked up. Now the interior on that left side, Alacqua in there quickly, Dean Iacobucci, number 55, with the hit as well.
Dick, I think what we're going to see, as we saw what Yale did, which was stack them up on the very first play, on that running play, is the quickness of the Yale defensive line. They're not very big against Dartmouth's very, very big offensive line.
5 yards for the first down. It is second down. Caraviello wants to go to the air for the first time, and it's complete at the 42-yard line. Scott Truitt.
Here's Scott Truitt, number 89, just running a quick out. He'll come down 4 steps, turn to his left. The ball is thrown on the break, as you can see. Steps out of bounds, a nice 5 or 6 yard gain for them. They'll try to run those quick outs all day long, test the corners.
Ball at the 42-yard line with a first down. Dartmouth's first of the afternoon. Round the ball carrier to the 42. Not much gain on the play. John Zanieski, the middle guard, 69, making the hit for Yale. Yeah. No gain on the play. Still 10 yards for the first down. Opening minute and a half of the ball game here at the Yale Bowl in New Haven, Yale and Dartmouth. Chambers in motion. Garaviello wants to throw. Again to that sideline. Fine catch at the 46-yard line by Burke. Matthew Burke and Carmen Alacqua making the tackle.
Straight back he drops. He's watching the field closely. He's waiting for the man to come across. Fine leaping catch coming across. There's no way really you can stop that. But you see they're going to throw short. They're going to take what they have. And they've had plenty of time to throw in the beginning.
That's what he's getting. And he's picked up 4 yards on the short gain. So it's third down and six now. Line of scrimmage, the 46 of Dartmouth. Number 14, Jeff Michelle, is out wide on the right side. Caraviello again to the air. And it's complete once again in Yale territory. Tony Rush making the stop. Scott Truitt, the receiver, number 89.
Well, we can see that the quarterback is going to the air early, and why not? Because most of his people have been open, and he's had plenty of time to throw. Look at all day he has to throw here. Nice pass to Truitt. Truitt's covered immediately, but they're giving their men time to get down into the pattern, time to get down into the defense. And the one problem that Yale's going to have with the lack of size on that defensive line is getting by the two big tackles, number 74 and number 75, Mike Martin, and also Bob Saylor and Slade Schuster. They're 6'4", 275. And you're talking about guys 2 or 3 inches smaller and about 40 pounds less trying to penetrate that offense.
Number 36, Tom Stevens, checks into the Dartmouth backfield as Rob Brown goes out. They're giving Truitt that short cut to the sidelines, and Caraviello's been taking it so far. Truitt's wide on the left. Now they're in the I formation on this first and 10 at the Yale 47. Again, Caraviello wants to go to that left side, and it's complete once again to the 41-yard line. Keenan makes the stop for Yale as Burke was the receiver.
They like to throw to their tight end, and again, as I said at the top of the show, they'll spread that offense around to all their receivers. They like to throw to their tight ends. They like Truitt. In fact, Caraviello right now, look at that number for him. He's 4 for 4 already.
Well, he's had nothing but green grass on those short pass patterns that he's throwing, and they're open. He'll take them. Second down and 4 now at the Yale 41. Dartmouth with the ball. Michelle in motion to the right side. Yale almost pops. They do. That's the second time they've gone onside on this drive, which began at the Dartmouth 29.
McKenna tried to pop right through between the center and the guard. It didn't quite make it. There he is, the culprit. It happens. Out of the I formation. Here comes 56 on the left side of your picture. Slip. Oops. Was he safe? No, he was out. He got caught.
Ardell McKenna, a junior out of Chicago. Economics major for Yale. 5 yards marked off. Also gives Dartmouth another first down.
And more confidence as we go along.
And driving Yale territory, the 36-yard line with the first down. Over the middle, Michelle wide open at the 25-yard line, and inside that before he is brought down by Kotkevich. Tim Kotkevich, the cornerback for the Elias, number 2.
That's the type of play that really puts the pressure on the cornerback, because it looks like the cornerback is also going to run an option. He starts out as if he's going to run the option, then he stops and hits him coming across. He's got single coverage. There's just no way to stop that.
As you know, yesterday, Yale was concerned about having the ability to contain Caraviello, not letting him run as well, because he can run very well. That's very close to the first down. Brown, the ball carrier, Rob Brown, number 42. The nose of it touches the 25-yard line.
That's called keeping it honest until you throw again.
Ardell McKenna made the tackle. Caraviello, how better can you be? 5 for 5, as you see.
You know, it's interesting, too, about both these quarterbacks, Caraviello and Curtin. They're both coming off injuries from last year, and both concerned, one with the ankle and the other one with the, I believe it's his left leg. So they want to try and control their running, but yet they're both such fine athletes, particularly Carviello, that it puts a lot of pressure on this defense. This drive has really been basically passes.
Began at the 29 of Dartmouth, and they're at the 25-yard line of the Elies. No score in the ball game. Dartmouth with the ball. Chambers shifts to the deep back in the eye. Chambers is hit as soon as the ball is handed off, and that is John Zanieski, who met him behind the line of scrimmage, number 69.
Number 69, John Zanieski, watch him beat the center. He just ran right by him. Oops, he almost had the quarterback and put down Chambers on top of it, and that was the big thing about him, is the way he initially beat the guy. There wasn't even any block. He ran right by the center.
Stevens goes out, and Rob Brown comes into the backfield, number 42. For Dartmouth. Chambers goes to a corner on that right side. Second down, 14 for the first down at the Yale 29. Pursuit for the first time pressure. Caraviello pursued by McKenna. Ardell McKenna with the ankle tackle.
Well, the wild man of Borneo, John Zanieski, who made the play before, actually beat the center again this time, and McKenna was blitzing from his inside linebacker position and put the pressure on. I think, Dick, they're going to have to do that more. They're going to have to send more people and take a chance.
For the first time this season, those two are together.
Here's Caraviello scrambling, might I say, putting the ball away to his left, and here comes McKenna. There is no way he's going to get by him. Fine shoestring tackle. He's got all of them.
Third down and 21 now. The line of scrimmage, the 36-yard line of Yale. Lots of time to throw. Pass is complete at the 26, but far short of the first down. Scott Truitt hit by Penders. Steve Penders, number 46.
But they're also getting in field goal range for Craig Fitzgaber. Not a great name. Number three, who's kicked from 50 yards out. So Salzgeber, who really kicks very well from 50 yards in.
He will be attempting a 46-yard field goal. His range, this is his range. This is well within his range. Salzberger puts his foot to it, but it's going to be way off the mark. No good, incomplete. Well, Dartmouth gives up the football, and Yale will go on offense for the first time this afternoon.
So much for the 50-yard range. And that's one of the things you're always concerned with the wind, and there is a great wind factor down there today, is a guy who is a sidewinder. Instead of coming straight onto the football, he comes from the side, and that wind's blowing. You saw it got up in the air, but it wasn't far enough.
Hello again, and welcome to another edition of the Yale Football Re-Air. This week, we're stepping back in the time machine and looking at the 1984 Yale-Dartmouth football game. As we do each week, we have a series of special guests, and our first one is two-time All-Ivy defensive lineman, John Zanieski. And John, my first question for you is a very simple one. Why Yale?
You know, that's a good story. I tell it all the time. I was back in the days, you know, football coaches are not allowed to come recruit you until after your senior season. And, I had visions of maybe playing football someplace close to home. I grew up in Pittsburgh, so, Slippery Rock State, Edinburgh. And one afternoon, about 2:00, the head football coach comes down and says, "Hey, John, somebody's here to see you." And so I walked in the room, and it was Dave Kelly. And, it was late in the afternoon, it was about 2:00 PM, and Dave was just a compelling guy. We're talking, and he's so exciting and so interesting, and I ended up missing my bus home, and Coach Kelly gave me a ride home and dropped me off, and I thought, wow, that was really cool. And so I went home, and back then you had to look in this book called Barron's Book of Colleges, and you'd look them up, and it would be like where it's located, how many students are there, what the average SAT scores are, et cetera, et cetera. And so I looked at it. I looked in the Barron's book and I couldn't. They were all sorted by state. And I knew, Yale was in New England. I'm just going through the New England states by heart. I'm like, Maine, Vermont, New Hampshire. And I totally missed Connecticut. The only thing I knew about Yale was Calvin Hill went to Yale. Because I used to, it was in one of my old football cards. Turned it over to Calvin Hill, Yale. So at some point somebody said it's in Connecticut. So then I looked it up and I was kind of intimidated. But then Coach Kelly called me back and said, John, look, just apply, and we'll get you up here to come take a look at the school. And, and that was the end of it. I applied, I came up, I visited. Coach Pont left me at the Hartford airport. They had to find a different way to get me down to New Haven. But I showed up, I stayed with Roger Javens. I had a great time. I thought, this is the best thing since, sliced bread. And, then the rest of the recruiting exercise was just a charade. It was just go through the other recruiting visits and bide my time until I can maybe get into Yale. And so that was it. I was hooked the day that Dave Kelly and Carm came to pick me up at what was back then the Sheraton Hotel, which is now I think the Omni down in on top of the old mall there. As soon as Coach Kelly and Coach Koza picked me up and dropped me off at Silliman to stay with Roger, I was sold on the place from then on.
I think we all have similar stories of falling in love with Yale the first time we lay eyes on it. But I want to go back to something else that you said, and that is assistant coach Dave Kelly. There are a lot of Dave Kelly stories out there, but what made him such a special assistant coach to you?
Yeah, he was just an inspiring guy. He just loved the game. He loved the guys. I mean, every other football coach would come and recruit you, and they'd always make sure to be done by 2:30 so you could all take the bus home. And Dave's just going at it and telling me how great Yale football is, and he's only too happy to drive me home. And, he literally just an excitement thing.
Last week in our re-air, we had another Dartmouth game, and it was the 2016 edition of this great rivalry. And we talked about Carm Koza as a radio broadcaster, but we also had Jack Ford come on and talk about his experiences with Carm as a coach. Do you have a specific story of Carm Koza that really stands out to you?
One day I was sitting in Coach Koza's office, and it was my junior year. We were bad. We had a bad season. We went 1-9 my junior year. We're all kind of down in the mouth, and I'm sitting in Coach Koza's office kind of looking for a bit of, coach, give me a chin up. I'm feeling down. And the phone rings, and coach picks it up, and it's Bo Schembechler. And it was Bo calling Carm, say, hey, these things will happen. I'm sitting there. Coach Koza knows Bo Schembechler. Bo just called him up to wish him, tell him chin up. And I'm asking Coach Koza for a chin up.
And that is a great story, and you guys did rebound in 1984. And when you look at the Yale football schedule, it's really easy to just look at the last 2 weeks of the season. But when we think about the Dartmouth game, that has always been a game that was very important to the New Haven community and always seemed to have huge crowds.
It's a turnaround game, as I recall. I mean, when you and I – created emails, and this one I was thinking Dartmouth game. So that season we came out, we lost to Brown in the opener. Then UConn beat us, because then UConn started to get to a point where, they were no longer a doormat to Yale. And I think we won the next week against Morgan State. And maybe we won the week after that against the hapless Columbia Lions, if I'm not mistaken, right? And of course, that felt good because it was during that era that Columbia had the longest running unwon streak in college football, And every week, somebody say, and Columbia added to their streak of being the worst college football team in history. It was always like a pin in my eye because I played on the last team that lost to Columbia my junior year. So anyhow, I think we beat Columbia. And then, you know, at that point, you'd beaten Morgan State, you'd beaten Columbia, and, you know, are we good, are we not good, you know. And so we played Dartmouth, and that kind of tipped the scales and said, you know, maybe there's something here.
You're right, and you guys really did have a great finish to the 1984 season. Well, John, we thank you for your time and your insight as we look back at this Dartmouth game from 1984.
Sure thing, Adam.
That was John Zanieski, two-time All-Ivy League performer on the defensive line, and we thank John very much for his time. We hope you're enjoying Yale and Dartmouth from 1984.
Is right there. Wouldn't you be much better off sneaking? Agree with me.
Dartmouth just picked up the first down.
Yeah. Okay, well, that's because he broke the tackle.
Absolutely right.
But it is tough, although that's a great play. Sound. It's very tough. If the guy made the tackle, you've got a 3 or 4 yard loss. Great reading offense from that tailback position, but the short yardage, I don't know.
First down now, Dartmouth at their own 37. Truett out wide on the right side. Michelle wide on the left. High formation. Yeah, with that three-man defensive front.
And they're blitzing off.
Caraviello wants to roll out again. And a fine grab by Michelle at the sideline. Kotkevich covering on the play, along with Jarkson. But what a fingertip grab by number 14 for Dartmouth.
By rolling the way he is and isolating one defensive back as he did this time with Michelle and sprinting towards him, you're making the defensive back make up his mind. He's either got to come up and make the play or let the other guy get behind him.
Michelle, coming into this ball game today, Upton, has had only 3 receptions. He's replacing the injured Mike McCorr out with a separated shoulder. Second down and 1, Dartmouth at their own 46. This time Rob Brown gets the call and picks up another Dartmouth first down.
Good, safe call, and what they're doing by setting up their passing game first, sooner or later it's going to loosen it up for the run game.
John Zanieski in on the stop. Second team All-Ivy player a year ago, he's an engineering major at Yale University.
Well, so far you haven't jinxed him yet. Look at Caraviello, 8 for 8.
8 for 8, 69 yards. And Yale would say on the other side of the ball, and no points. 4:41 left in this first quarter as the stakes go out again. And it's another Dartmouth first down. Yale's had the ball 1:20, and Dartmouth has owned the first quarter with 8:59 worth of possession. Let's call it 9.
The score is still 0-0. You know, they last week against the Holy Cross went in the last quarter and tied them 20-20 and really had some bad breaks. That's why I say this team is very dangerous at this time of year. They played 3 tough games in a row.
Line of scrimmage, 47-yard line with the first down, Dartmouth. Caraviello, number 11, the quarterback. Yale stacks that line now. They're showing blitz, but Caraviello is going long count.
And they made
both teams move this time. So was Dartmouth drawn, or did Dartmouth's Burke go offside?
I think Dartmouth was offside.
Number 82, Burke, appeared to have moved. Offside, Dartmouth is the call.
Well, that's not a bad idea to keep coming up there and faking the blitz, although this time they were coming. McKenna was coming, as he's done the last couple of times. But you just get those offensive linemen thinking just a little bit, Dick, and they begin to move.
Dartmouth across the front. The tackles are Mike Martin, 74, and Slade Schuster, 75. 275 and 240. Dartmouth with 6 first downs in the ball game. Yale, of course, only had the ball 3 plays and punted, so they have none. First and 15 now for Dartmouth at their own 42. Chambers in motion to the left. And Caraviello right out in the flat to Chambers. And hanging on for the Elias is Tony Resch, number 49, the monster back, who covered that very well.
That didn't fool anybody. They sent the strength of the offense of the formation to the left and screened back to the right side. Number 40, Kurt Alakwa, is isolated here. He assists on this tackle. It was made initially. Good footwork, though, huh? He could be a dancer somewhere.
He is Yale's outstanding linebacker who has been out with a broken hand. He's been playing, but he now is just about fully recovered. Second down, 19 for Dartmouth at their own 38. That's Chambers in motion again. Caraviello has a lot of time and a wide open receiver in Scott Truitt at the 38-yard line of Yale as Mike Jarkson makes the stop, number 39, but not after big yardage, and another first down has been picked up by Dartmouth.
All night, Dick, he has to throw, and that time again, right behind the two linebackers, their two best linebackers, 56 Ardell McKenna and number 40 Carmen Alaco, who we saw on the ISO just a minute or so ago. With all that time to throw, all they're doing is sending the receivers down and in behind the linebackers and in front of the defensive backs. There's no way to stop it. That was only one receiver that time.
Number 89 has been the man to watch so far for Dartmouth as Caraviello has found him to be his favorite target. Michelle shifts into a slot out the left and Chambers goes off the right side. Tackled at the 36-yard line is Chambers by John Zanieski, number 69, the middle guard.
Well, he's still doing it. I'll tell you, don't jinx him. 10 for 10
is Caraviello, 88 yards. And Truitt with four receptions and 49 yards for Dartmouth.
You really have to admire what Dartmouth's been able to do with Wiseman out, their fine tailback, who was their leading rusher and receiver. They're spreading the offense out and not putting too much pressure on the tailback.
Second and 8 now for Dartmouth at the Yale 36. And Caraviello wants to go downtown looking for Truitt. And a wrong shoulder as Truitt had to look left, turn right, and it was over his shoulder. Penders, number 46, covering on the play.
Scott Truitt, number 89, is really their best wide receiver, a long strider with really good speed. In fact, he's got track speed. Now watch the move he makes to the inside first on Penders. He sees the ball turning the other way. This is what I call great adjustment on the ball. He almost caught that thing. It might not look it on the screen, but he'd be very close to making a great adjustment on the ball.
Well, he can adjust very well because he's a computer science major at Dartmouth. Third down and 8 now for Dartmouth at the Yale 36. Yale with 5 men up on the defensive line.
And they're all coming.
Here they come. And he gets the ball off, but it's incomplete this time off the fingertips of Scott Truitt. Penders covering 46.
Was a little behind Truitt, but he was wide open. The minute you send all your linebackers, then that opening is there.
Dartmouth now with a punting situation. Unable to pick up the yardage. Still 8 yards for the first down. And on a 4th and 8, Dartmouth says, we're going to go.
Why not?
Why not? At the Yale 36. Chambers in motion. And Caraviello looking for Michelle, and it's overthrown at the 2-yard line. Kutkevich going back there with him. So on a 4th and 6, Dartmouth does not convert. Yale takes over the football.
It was a good pattern, and there's nothing wrong with the way the wind is now and your field goal kicker not able to make it from there to try that pattern. I might have tried something a little bit shorter, but also Kutkevich came very close to interference on that play.
You can make it if you try.
Minute and 40 seconds to play in this first quarter. Yale getting the ball for the second time in this first quarter. Mike Curtin, number 7, the quarterback. Junior out of Salt Lake City, Utah. Rick Coase stacked up at the line of scrimmage. That's Greg Cole, the rover back from Dartmouth, number 8, who was just on top of him as soon as he got to the line of scrimmage.
Might as well have him, that rover back, in their scheme of defense. Really playing up on the line as a linebacker, and they know they're going to run the football. That's one danger, Dick. It's early yet when your defense, like Yale, has been on the field, even though Dartmouth hasn't scored twice, they begin to get tired early. We're not even at the end of the first quarter yet.
Second down and 8, Yale, their own 38. Kevin Moriarty will be the one to watch for Yale, number 82, who's back in the lineup for the first time this season. They go over the middle. That's complete to Luzzi, the wingback for Yale, at the 46-yard line, very close to a first down. He is tackled by Peter Wade, 55, of Dartmouth.
Mike Curtin drops straight back, and he's waiting for number 10, Mike Luzzi, a former quarterback, right in behind the defense. And that is that.
Mike
Lozzi. It's a very simple pass pattern, too.
Playing in the shadow of his home in East Haven, Connecticut.
Well, he's also a former quarterback. That's interesting about Carmen Cozy. He's taken two or three guys and spread them out on the offense that used to be quarterbacks.
Well, Lozzi was the quarterback last season. He started, and he did not get the job done. He just couldn't get it done. So then Curtin took the job away from him. First down, Yale. They're first of the ball game. Rick Coes keeps his balance. Great second effort running by Coes to the 42-yard line of Dartmouth and close to another first down.
Actually, it looked like his hand was down. The lead is by Dave Klein, number 35. The give is to Coes. He follows off Klein's block, and he just keeps going. It appears to me twice you can see that his left hand was down.
Yale's second first down. 18 seconds on the clock running down in this first quarter. And
good second effort by
Good Kurt. Second effort, right, by Kurt. He kept the ball himself, and that'll run out the first quarter. And at the end of the first quarter, there is no score between Yale and Dartmouth, and we have a message now of special interest. Close to 35,000 looking on here in New Haven this afternoon at the Yale Bowl as they look at Yale with a second down and six at the Dartmouth 38. First play of the second quarter. Rick Coes gets it inside the 35, close to the 34-yard line. Len Fontes makes the tackle, number 53, the inside linebacker for Dartmouth.
It looks like they're going to find out how good this defense is. Dartmouth has had a lot of people injured, including their linebackers, in the first couple of games. And one of their players, Len Fontes, number 53, his father, one of the boys plays one place, but his father coaches for the New York Football Giants.
Defensive backfield coach, third down and three, Yale, at the 34 of Dartmouth. Rick Coes picks up the first down. And gets a fumble, and he fumbles the football. But is the play dead or not? Play is dead. Play was blown dead as Coes picked up the first down.
Good call by the official. He was down, and the ball was dead. And they're going to that old Yale power football right out of the eye with the fullback leading. They're getting good blocking up front. And Coes is really running well. He comes right off the back again of number 35, Dave Klein. Look at those legs keep going. He goes down. You can't see the ball. It popped out afterwards, but he was down.
Yale with a first down at the Dartmouth 27, their deepest penetration of the ball game so far. Mike Curtin wants to throw, looking for Moriarty, and he overthrows him at the 6-yard line.
And he's got a flag down, too. I believe that they were called for holding.
Carson was covering on the play, number 26. Kevin Moriarty, number 82, was Yale's leading receiver last year. This is his first game playing. Had a severely injured ankle. Holding was the call against Yale.
Now it's hard to fathom getting a holding call when your quarterback is rolling. If he's straight back in the pocket, your linemen certainly have a tendency to grab when people go by him, but it's more difficult, and I'm sure a coach really must be upset when a guy gets called for holding when the quarterback is rolling away from the play.
Upton, how important is it for a team to score first in this ball game?
Well, in any game,
with
I think
the records of both of these schools, I mean, emotionally, does it?
I thought it was more important for Dartmouth to score first, particularly when they've been down there twice. I think that Yale, with their power, at least what we've seen when they've had the ball, is a stronger team, probably.
First and 20 now for Yale. Curtin wants to go upstairs again. This time he takes off. He's hit hard at the 33-yard line. Fontas in there first and Wade over there also. 53 and 55 for Dartmouth on defense.
That's the strength of their defense. Out of the I formation, he's dropping straight back. He's got time to throw, but he decides they're all covered and he takes off for the races. Good coverage here. Fontas number 53, Peter Wade number 55. That is the strength of their defense, by the way, in their linebackers. Cordovan, Fontas, Wade, and Ed Simpson number 81.
Second and 15, Yale at the Dartmouth 32. The draw play to Klein. He high steps to the 25.
And does he high step?
Ed Simpson, number 81, was the first one to hit him for Dartmouth, but still a long way. It's third and long yardage. Time of possession, interesting. Dartmouth has just owned it so far, 11 minutes and 58 seconds to Yale's 3 minutes and 2 seconds. However,
Yale
the scoreboard is 0-0.
But the other thing is Yale has moved the ball well on the ground. I'll tell you, I wouldn't throw the football too much if I could move it this way on the ground.
Moriarty goes out there wide on the right for the Elias at the 24 of Dartmouth. Over the middle, it's complete. McCauley, the receiver, and he's tackled by Peter Kortbein, inside linebacker 94 for Dartmouth. Ted McCauley, a sophomore out of Saratoga, California.
And one of their punt returners and kickoff returners. McCauley just sneaks in behind the defense. The linebackers are dropping too deep in this case, and McCauley, 26, catches it. Watch the way he turns himself upfield and then is immediately crunched.
Crunched, but made the first down for Yale. So Yale at the 16-yard line of Dartmouth in the second quarter. Dave Klein, the fullback, number 35. Rick Coase, 31, the tailback. Rick Coase spins off inside the 10 to the 8. Hit by Greg Cole and Dan Carson.
I like the way Coase gets into that hole. We'll watch him going into the hole here, following the fullback, number 35, Klein. Coase will cut right off his tail. The block is outside. He runs inside. Also, number 7, that's Mike Curtin, the quarterback, throwing a block in there, too.
Second down now and 3 for the first down. Line of scrimmage, the 9 of Dartmouth. Dave Klein slices off the right guard, Jerry Wozlowski. Andy Osmond, 91, closes down the hole.
I think if we have to say that offensive line, 71, Wimers, 54, Matthews, Martinson, are all doing the job, and they've got a first down.
And goal to go from the 5-yard line.
That is not a big offensive line either, Dick. That's what impresses me about them on this drive. They're just really driving Dartmouth off the line of scrimmage.
All right, Elias from the 5 with a first down. High formation. Goes to the 3-yard line. Peter Wade, number 55, makes the hit for Dartmouth, the outside linebacker. Remember yesterday, Zanieski told us, Carm Coase of the Yale coach told us, they're very used to being outweighed. They're so used to that, that every team they play is so much bigger than they are.
They are, but I think that the defense, the front 3 of Dartmouth, is getting pushed back, which puts more pressure on their linebackers.
Second down, goal to go, the 2.5-yard line. Luzzi's wide on the left. Into the end zone, touchdown, Dave Klein for Yale.
Right over the center, Dave Klein, pure power football, and that's the idea of giving it to the fullback instead of the tailback when you only have a yard to go.
And the center is number 51, Martin Martinson, the captain of Yale, their 112th captain from Durango, Colorado. Dave Klein, a junior out of Fargo, North Dakota. And this man, number 3, Bill Moore, out of Bellevue, Washington.
So does that say this is an all-West team?
It looks that way, doesn't it? Moore just slams it through, and it's good, and Yale leads Dartmouth 7-0.
You'll see how close to the ground Dave Klein gets. Take a look at the center, Martin Martinson. He drives this man off. Look at the knees. Look at the bones, crushing and crunching. Right behind the center, Marty Martinson, 51. That's a great shot. He rolls over in the end zone. He doesn't high-five it. He just gives the ball to the official because Yale scores. And that was an important drive for Yale. Second time they really had the ball. They've hardly had it in the first quarter. And they take it down really more on power football than anything else out of Carmen Close's favorite offense, the eye.
And more importantly, I guess for Yale too as well, the offense kept the defense off the field. They also consumed time off the clock. There's 10 minutes and 11 seconds remaining in the second period as Yale goes out to its 7-0 lead.
This experience, it lives on our fields and in our classrooms, where every day is a test. Each moment builds on this experience and creates an environment that develops mind, body, and soul. We become part of the storied traditions of the Ivy League. This experience, it is unrivaled.
Tim Duax will be the deep man along with Lorenzo Chambers. Bill Moore, number three. His range on kickoffs usually does not go beyond the 10. Now we'll see. He's kicking into a win. Sidewinder.
It's the best thing to do, put the ball on the ground. Look at them running after it like a marble.
Out of bounds on the two, so we'll do it all over again. How wise it was not to touch that football. Watch it, let it go out of bounds.
Still, if he has to come back and he's penalized again, it's better putting the ball on the ground. You saw all of them looking. Why is it that backs and receivers, when you kick off, are not used to picking up the ball off the ground? They all catch it in the air. When somebody puts it down, they act like they're shocked.
Well, you see, 6 minutes and 29 seconds consumed on the clock on that scoring drive of Yale's.
And the big thing that you mentioned is it keeps that defense, who really had to play the whole first quarter, off the field. I still suspect that Dartmouth's offense will continue to throw the football. As you can see, they don't, although they have some speed in the tailback position with Chambers and Duax, it isn't Wiseman back there. And when you can't throw and have your tailback work a lot, throw to him and have him run, and you have to spread it out, then it's a different ball game.
The deep man for Dartmouth, Lorenzo Chambers and Tim Duax. Time Moore kicking from the 35. Duax drops it. Across the 30 to the 32-yard line. Mike Ryan of Yale, number 29, makes the tackle.
Each time, Dick, Dartmouth has had good field position. There's no reason why they can't move the football with this passing game. Going to have the whole right side of this field, the wide side, open on their opening play. I might throw it on the opening play.
Well, I'm not going to be surprised to see this young man, Mr. Caraviello, go upstairs. 32-yard line of Dartmouth is the line of scrimmage. And Rob Brown is grabbed from behind by John Zanieski, number 69.
Yale seems to have, every time you look up, every other year, a great middle guard. Zinger, what, 3 years ago, 2 years ago? They're all small, they're all quick, and they're all very strong. Is that what Koza does, your buddy? Is that the first thing he does before he gets the tailback? He goes out and gets the middle guard?
He gives you a pound of nails to eat first. Caraviello, 10 for 13, 88 yards.
I never tried that.
Second and 10 now. 32 yards.
They're coming.
And again, though, over the middle, wide open, Lorenzo Chambers cannot hang on. Right in front of Jarkson, number 39, but the pass is incomplete.
They had it set up beautifully. They let them through, but almost too quickly, and he got rid of the ball, but Chambers said, what is this? That, again, is the difference. Wiseman was their leading pass receiver from the tailback position.
Here's some scores. Pennsylvania Brown scoreless, Princeton scoreless, and Harvard out in front of Cornell. 7-0, all in the first period. Third down now in 10. Got Truett, has it, and drops the football. Incomplete. So two consecutive plays. The fault cannot go to that man, number 11.
I think that he turned around and saw 56 Ardell McKenna staring him right straight in the face. It's twice in a row that a back has dropped the ball. Here Truett has a hold of it, and he begins to run. He plays with it, but look at number 56. He was heading straight for his shoulder pad.
Elwin Fields doing the punting. Line of scrimmage is the 32. Ted McCauley in single safety for Yale, back at around the 28.
Line drive.
Return to the 46, and Sean McDonough on the sidelines.
No, this is not Upton Bell. This is Dante Santori. He's in the sousaphone section of the Yale band. Dante, get up. What year are you in here?
Well, I'll tell you what, that might not be Upton Bell, but maybe he ought to go over on the other side and play for Dartmouth. If he can hold that head plume, he might hold the football.
Sorry about the audio problems. We'll hope to have that one corrected very shortly. First down, Yale at the 41, their own. Yale leading 7-0 here in the second quarter. Looking for Mike Stewart, incomplete. Back there covering Don Pomeroy for Dartmouth, number 15.
That's as close as you're going to come to a touchdown, because he had Pomeroy beaten. The pass was right on the mark, and it went right through his hands.
Pomeroy almost batted it down.
Curtin's got the time to throw now, and he is winding up and throwing. This is a beautiful post pattern, but watch the way Pomeroy knocks it down at the last minute. He had him beaten. It's 18. Mike Stewart had him beaten on a post pattern.
Second and 10 now. Line of scrimmage, the L-41. Dave Klein. Don Pomeroy, the captain for Dartmouth, number 15, drives him down. 48-yard line, third down and 3 for the first down.
Klein really makes a nice run. You see the jab step and the hand off to Klein. He's heading in behind his guard and his tackle. Watch him use his hand off his guard to get around the corner. Brought down by Pomeroy, but he just snuck in behind his lineman and used him beautifully.
3 yards for that first down. Complete to Marwiti. And Marwiti has the first down, and he gets a block as well from Coase. Gets a great block from Martinson, rather, number 51. Dan Carson brings him down. Yale picks up the first down.
Quarterback has plenty of time to throw, and it gives Marwiti, number 33, coming from the left side and coming across the right side. Great block there. I can't pick out his number. Number 10 comes back across again, Luzzi, and makes a fine block. Here's quarterback number 94. You think he didn't get creamed here? He's going one way. Marwiti's going the other way, but that's the way that offensive play is set up.
First down, Yale at the Dartmouth 36. Inside the 35 to the 33. Picks up about 3, so it'll be second down and 7. Cordobine making the tackle, 94 for Dart.
See, he did get up after that play. Joe Yukika is not very happy, and everything has kind of turned around on his club since their domination in the first quarter.
Yale has been penalized 4 times for 25 yards, and Dartmouth 2 times for 20 yards.
Looks like the band's happy.
Second and 7 from the 33 of Dartmouth.
Here they come.
And Curtin gets sacked back at the 41 as Cole is in there and Wade is in there, along with Ed Simpson putting the pressure on.
This time, in order to get some pressure on the passer, which they had not been getting, Dick, they send both their wide people, Peter Wade, 55, and 81, Ed Simpson. He's dropping straight back. But 81 coming from your left side and 55 from your right side with the Crunch Twins, Peter Wade and Ed Simpson. They're two outside backers. This time they have to send those people. They're not going to get to the passer.
Yale is 3 for 4 in third down conversions. Dartmouth is 2 for 5. Line of scrimmage, the 41. It is third and 14 for Yale. Incomplete. Peter Wade covering the intended receiver, then a little flag back at the 40-yard line. And ineligible receiver downfield.
And maybe holding, too? Combination?
And the sides exchange as Yale puts his punting unit out on the field. It'll be fourth down coming up.
Watch number 82 being held up. And this is what they try to do. They bump him on the line of scrimmage. You remember when Peter Wade, number 55, was running with him. Tried to hold him up. That's Kevin Moriarty, who has been hurt, Dick, in the first three games. And he really is one of their great receivers. As the band plays, we'll find out what the penalty is.
But you can't hold the guy.
Getting back to Kevin Moriarty for a second, this is the game that they wanted to bring him back in. He had the bad ankle. And he is probably their best deep threat. And Koza feels one of the best wide receivers they've ever had.
Henry Eaton punting for Yale on his fourth and 19. Fair catch signaled for and out of bounds. Let's see where they mark it. Poor punt. But they're marking it at the 23. That's where Dartmouth will pick it up.
It's been a great start to this 1984 Yale-Dartmouth football game, and we're pleased to be joined by another special guest, an offensive lineman on that team, and it's Otto Wimer. And Otto, I will ask you the first question that I asked John Zanieski, and that is simply, why Yale?
I picked Yale for a couple different reasons. My dad was an alum. I had an older brother a year ahead. And of all the teams that I was being recruited by, I loved Coach Koza. He stuck out amongst the crowd of being, you know, just heads and shoulders above all the rest of the coaches.
We talked a lot last week about Coach Koza, and I'll ask you the same question as I asked our guest last week. Do you have a Coach Koza story that really stands out?
You know, I think the overall image is he's a second dad. I think for me and for most of the guys on the team, he's someone who, you know, provided counsel, perspective, and was always there to talk to. You don't find that in a lot of coaches, particularly a big Division I and 1AA programs, but it was a huge, you know, attraction for me and, you know, support for me in my 4 years at Yale.
Otto, as an offensive lineman, we don't normally like to hear our names called because that usually means that something bad happened. But it's really been a tradition here at Yale for great camaraderie among the offensive lines, and that's a tradition that started in your time and continues to this day.
It's something we were known as Toads, you know, we liked our reputation as always being sort of in the mud and getting dirty, but, you know, I count a number of my closest friends as guys that I were in my class at Yale as offensive linemen. One of my roommates, Jerry Wasilowski, Marty Martinson, our team captain, and then on the opposite side of the ball, we had a couple of younger guys, but it was a group that stuck together, and you're right. The only time you usually heard our names was either on the announcement that we were one of the five offensive linemen that were starting, or that something bad had happened. Not, hey, you threw a great block, and, you know, let's talk about the block you made.
Moving to this Dartmouth game, you guys were 1-2 on the year after a win in a non-conference game against Morgan State, and John Zanieski mentioned it, but after a terrible 1983 season and then a slow start to 1984, this game was really a turning point for the Bulldogs.
Yeah, it was. I mean, you know, to set the parameters, my sophomore and junior year were the two worst seasons in Yale history. So coming into senior year, we had a lot to prove. And this game in particular was very important to us and sort of what's our trajectory going to be? Are we going to end up with a winning season or losing season? So it wasn't just pressure on this game, but on a pressure every game that season.
Watching this game, you really get to see conflicting offensive styles. Dartmouth wants to throw the ball all over the field. But for the Bulldogs, you guys were able to come out and establish and dominate in the run game.
For us, the running game was key. With Curtin at quarterback, we had someone that was a great passer. But, you know, historically, Carm's offenses, you know, used the pass occasionally, but that wasn't the real armament. It was the running game. And with the line we had, you know, we leveraged that in this game in particular, but throughout the season.
That was Yale offensive lineman Otto Wimer, member of the class of 1985. And we hope you're enjoying the Yale-Dartmouth football game from back in 1984.
Fifteen big ones are going off on Yale.
Illegal substitution is the call. 12 men on the field. You can't play with 12. 11 in the rule book.
They didn't talk to Walter Camp, who was the first coach and a great player here with his own rules committee, because he would have legislated another way, so they would have been taken care of for that.
First down at the 14-yard line of Yale. Chambers gets the call and takes it to about the 11.
Well, they're using a little power themselves now and taking advantage of that big offensive line running behind those two big tackles they have, 74 Mike Martin and 75 Slade Schuster. And this is where your advantage should count for you, Dick. If it doesn't down here, you're not going to block anybody.
Carl Costa, number 92 in the lineup for Yale, the middle guard. He's from Northford, Connecticut. Timeout. We're going to pause just a moment in our coverage of this game between the Big Green and the Bulldogs with the score Yale 7, Dartmouth nothing.
You can make it if you try.
Dartmouth has a second down and 7 at the 11-yard line of Yale, trying to tie the score up. Chambers in motion. Stevens, the ball carrier, inside to the 7. Bob Keenan, number 81, the defensive end, gets there first for the Elias.
He was stopped at the line of scrimmage and bounced to his right. And, you know, he's not a very quick back, but he's a very strong back. At 220 pounds, their biggest back. And he was stopped dead at the line of scrimmage by number 84, Pat Maloney, but then bounced to the right. Got a few more in. Dick, I think it's so important for Dartmouth to score now. This has happened 3 weeks in a row when they've needed to score and at the wrong times have not.
Chambers has 7 carries for 25 yards in a ball game. Third down and 4. From
timeout.
The 7-yard line, and timeout called again.
Maybe it's a point that's overdone about a team that makes mistakes or is not ready mentally when they should be. Again, to go back to what has happened to Dartmouth, they have a pretty good football team. They were in the game early, and they were also, well, we'll go to Sean McDonough and then come back.
Thanks, Upton. Down here on the sidelines with Rich Weissman, Dartmouth's fine back who's been out with a knee injury. Rich, how'd you hurt yourself?
I hurt it last week on a kickoff return. I did on a cut. I wasn't hit on the play, but I pivoted on my leg and then the knee just went, sort of a freak accident.
What's the time frame as far as your return?
I'm hoping only about a week and a half, 2 weeks. I'm not really sure. The ligament's gone, so I have to rehab it and see how that goes. It'll depend when I get back.
Seems like your team has been moving the ball pretty well here today. Just haven't been able to stick it in.
Michael's really doing a good job out there. I think right now it's going to be our time to score, and I think definitely that we're going to come back and take it.
Rich, good luck in your comeback. Thanks a lot for talking to us. That's Rich Weissman, fine player. Back to the booth.
Third down and 4 from the 7-yard line. Dartmouth driving. Caraviello over the middle.
Wide open.
Keir. Doug Keir, touchdown.
That was beautiful faking on that play by Caraviello. he really got them going one way and got Keir isolated on a defensive back, and Keir is about 3 or 4 inches taller. We're going to take two different looks at this. Here's Keir rolling to his right, and he's got in the corner of the end zone number 87, Doug Keir. Caraviello rolling to his right and hitting Keir in the end zone. Here's another look. What's the way he hides the ball, fakes it. Now he gives Keir time to clear in the left corner of the end zone. Nice catch, puts the ball away, nice throw.
Extra point attempt is good, and this ball game is tied up at 7-7 between Yale and Dartmouth.
Well, they did it this time. They got themselves back in the game at the right time, scoring when they needed to score, and Keir, who we had talked to Joe Kika a lot about during this week, made the catch. Again, with that size and that speed they have, and this great faking by the quarterback, scores tied. Take another look now from a third angle. He's now set up, Caraviello, with a man in his face. That's the other part of what we didn't see in the beginning. Keir makes really a nice catch, but the height advantage and beating his man with single coverage. But the fake made the play, and also was a heck of a throw by Caraviello with a man right in his face.
Some scores from around the country. Air Force out in front of Notre Dame, 14-7 in the second period. West Virginia leading Syracuse 13-7 in the third period. At the half, it is South Carolina 21, Pitt 14 in the second period. Michigan 10, Northwestern nothing. In the World Series, after two innings in Detroit, it is, what do we have? Detroit 2, San Diego 1.
That's all over with.
Eugene Prophet deep for Yale, number 88. And Salzgeber's kickoff is dropped by Prophet, picked up. He is the fastest man on the Yale team. And goes down at about the 27-yard line.
Well, you can't be fast unless you pick the ball up, and he had a flying start that time.
He is playing, if you'll notice, his two fingers are taped together. He had surgery on his thumb, and it's not really healed properly, and he plays with it taped, and he has a great deal of problem with that situation.
We ought to take him off the kickoff team, huh?
First down, Yale at the 27. Luzzi comes in motion. McCauley, the ball carrier, number 26. He just racked up by the interior of that Dartmouth defensive unit.
Isn't it funny how when you score, we'll take a look at the center, Marty Martinson, the captain from Yale. He should have his big Yale sweater on. Nice cross block here on 91 Osmond. Just stands him up. The ball carrier comes in right behind. You're really burying yourself when you do that, but it's fine block by Marty Martinson.
Second down and 8 at the 29. 7-7 ball game here in the second period with 2:35 to go.
Option.
McCauley goes the other way. McCauley high steps it, breaks out of the pack. 71 yards for a touchdown. Ted McCauley, no flags downfield.
He's tired. That's a long run.
Seventy-one yards
scamper by McCauley, and he changes direction. It's a quarterback option with the toss to McCauley. He sees there's nothing there. Back to his right to cut in beside number 75, Schuster, and he is off to the races for the only guy near him, his own quarterback. Goodbye. Never will he be again this lonely and this happy and this tired in the end zone, but fine change of direction by McCauley. He was completely stopped on the left side.
Sophomore from Saratoga, California. Bill Moore's extra point. It's good. And Yale has gone back out in front of Dartmouth, 14-7.
Looks like the cheerleaders were part of that offensive display. The band's happy and everything, but McCauley really showing fine change of direction, Dick, because he had started on his left side with part of the quarterback option with Klein leading. The toss to McCauley, started to his left. You know, that's a very difficult instinct to teach a back, because a lot of guys change direction and they're tackled on their own bench. This guy changed direction and used his blocker 75, Schuster, beautifully to go 71 yards. But nothing like that also after you've driven all the length of the field yourself for a touchdown on Dartmouth's part. Pretty much shut down Yale a little bit. Expect to get the football back before halftime, and a guy makes a great run and puts you down 7 points again. And actually, it's on a broken play.
Could be called a backbreaker, that kind of a play coming so quickly after you've just tied the ball game. Dropping back deep is Tim Duax, number 45 for Dartmouth. Lorenzo Chambers, number 35, back there with him on the left side. Duax you're looking at, and Bill Moore getting set to kick off. Duax. Duax returns it close to the 25 as Rush and Flannery, 49 and 45, form a tandem for the tackle.
Well, if you're successful throwing, I come out and throw it right away.
Interesting now, up. Dartmouth has no timeouts left in this first half. And there you see the statistics on the scoring drive.
But the stats never tell the story. Some people like to use them, but they don't tell that story because it was a 71-yard run on a broken play.
Lorenzo Chambers, number 35. Look at him in high step.
Well, they evidently think that right side of the Yale defense is pretty easy to penetrate. Chambers is really a very quick back. Number 35 isolated. Little jab step to the right and then back to his left. He cut right off number 74. Mike Martin, nice move too. Then he was hit by half of the Yale team.
Picked up the first down though at the 41. Caraviello is going to go down. Is going to go down. That's Ardell McKenna and Dean Iacobucci, number 55, who come barreling in there.
Iacobucci hit him 55 from the blind side. He didn't know he was there, and that's the most difficult thing to have happen. You see at the very end, there's number 55, the end, Dean Iacobucci, giving him what looked like a karate chop as he went down. He looked like he had some people open on the left side of the field, but he never saw Iacobucci, and he is not big either. He's just very quick.
Second down and 20 now for Dartmouth at their own 31. Chambers in motion. Incomplete pass with just a minute and 9 seconds left to play in this first half as pass incomplete.
There's Ted McCauley again. He's still happy. He hasn't gotten over this. He's going to celebrate all the way to the locker room. And who knows at the end of this game whether that's the play that broke Dartmouth's back. It appears now with more pressure being put on by Yale that the quarterback, Caraviello, as he's dropping straight back, is throwing the ball into the ground.
Third down and 20 now from the 31. Split on both sides.
Pressure.
Chambers out in the flat.
They're out of bounds.
Forced outside. Stops the clock as well. It's Bob funny. Keenan drives him out.
The point you made, no timeouts for Dartmouth. Again, hurting themselves mentally when they are down on the first scoring play. Two timeouts in a row, and now they have none left when they want to come back and be in this ball game. They're only 7 points down before the end of the half.
Owen Fields will be punting. He's standing at his own 25. McCauley's back there at his own 20. Line of scrimmage is the 39. Go, go! 36-yard punt as McCauley hauls it in. McCauley, he breaks for the sideline, goes out of bounds at the 39. This young man has visions of doing it again as he high-stepped there for a brief second. McCauley's 71-yard run is Yale's longest since 1981. And Rich Diana ran for 80 yards against Brown.
And Diana really wasn't known as a breakaway back. The thing I like about McCauley is the way he sidesteps people. He really runs well, runs the angles well. Now the question is, do you want your quarterback in the position they're in, which is pretty good field position, to run the clock out? Or do you want to go for more? I might try and pour it on.
52 seconds left. I think it's very important that Yale goes to the locker room with a lead.
Well, then throw the ball deep.
Earlier in the season trying to do that in the first half against Connecticut.
If they get an interception, throw it deep.
All right, they're going upstairs. Up, they listen to you. Curtain breaks out. It's caught on the sideline there.
Our man
McCauley. Our man McCauley, yeah.
I believe in that case he was the outlet. That actually he was looking deep, and McCauley who is the outlet man. Good throw by the quarterback. Good safe throw when nobody was open deep.
Second and four. Kevin Moriarty, does he hang on? No, he does not.
That's called catching the ball for only the second time, for the first time all year long in his first game, and that's going to happen. Moriarty, by the way, is wearing a protective brace on that ankle. I guess it was a very severe injury he had last year and re-injured it again this year.
Third down now and four for Yale at the 45. 14-7 Eli lead, 23 seconds to go in the first half. In third down conversions, Yale in his football game is 3 for 5. Dartmouth 2 for 6 in the first half.
Wouldn't that be a bad idea to screen it now and run out the clock? See if they're putting the pressure on.
Dave Klein goes out of bounds in front of the Dartmouth bench. Len Fontes drives him out, number 53. It's a first down. That automatically stops the clock, but he went out of bounds and stopped it anyway.
That's one part of college football that I really like better than the pro game, the idea of stopping the clock. Or when a guy makes a first down, first of all, if the team's moving well enough, then you don't have the situation of the officials getting the defensive lineman down there in position and time ticking off the clock just because nobody's in position and somebody getting a penalty. I like the clock being stopped even if the game is longer.
First down at the 46, but there are 17 seconds left to play in the first half. Flag is dropped. Pass is complete at the 30, but there's a flag dropped on the play. Pomeroy made the tackle on Luzzi.
Holding
you. Luzzi.
Have to figure out, Dick.
I would assume.
Here on the replay, we see nice drop back by Curtin. He's got time to throw. He sent one man deep, and then he just clears Luzzi across the middle. Nice catch by Luzzi. Puts the ball away. This is another angle. You can see him dropping behind the linebackers with only 15. Kehoe there. He gives him a little shot, and he goes down, but unfortunately, holding.
Holding is the call, right.
Holding penalty on the offense, first down.
10 seconds to play in this second quarter. Profit checks into the lineup, Eugene Profit, so look for him to go downtown. He's the fastest man in the Yale team, so he go for broke on this last play. 4-3, is it even going to get off? No, it will not get off. 2-1, that is the end of the first half.
They want a timeout, too.
What do we have here? That is it. The end of the first half with the score, Yale 14 and Dartmouth 7.
I think it's anybody's game still. I mean, we had one team dominated, Dartmouth, in the first quarter, Dick. Yale come out and really run the football well. Then Dartmouth come back and got themselves back into a game. And really, I hate to say throw away a 71-yard great run by McCauley, but really throw it away and the game's almost even.
I think the key, though, is early in the first quarter when Dartmouth put together two strong drives and came up empty with no points whatsoever, including even 3 for a field goal, when the first attempt of 46 yards was within the range of Salzkeberg. And Yale comes back, goes out in front, takes that lead, and then breaks it with McCauley's 71-yard run and has the 14-7 halftime lead. Yale will never forget a year ago when they led 21-3 going to the locker room, only to lose the football game to Dartmouth.
Assuming the game is close, though, and we're assuming going the fourth quarter it will be, the team that's throwing the ball the best, I think, is going to win the game. And that's what happened last year. Although I believe that Yale's power game has now been established, particularly in that second quarter at the line of scrimmage, that they can do pretty much what they want running on the ground. Dartmouth knows they must throw the football to score. I mean, nobody's kidding anybody in that situation. But I think if they're within distance in the fourth quarter, the passing team will win the game.
Upton Bell, by the way, was one of the spectators at yesterday's Yale-Dartmouth freshman game.
Okay, Yale. Good defense. Stop them now. Perfect.
Hey, I love good defense. Good defense is good offense. What better day to have good offense than on a Friday afternoon? Instead of having tea, we've got the Yale freshman versus the Dartmouth freshman. And this is the perfect place to have it, in the Yale Bowl. 70 years old, second oldest stadium in the country, with more tradition than probably any other college football team we've ever seen. Over 700 victories here. It's amazing. It all started before Butch and Sundance took care of the West. Yeah, a guy by the name of Walter Camp came along and he said, listen, I'm going to take the game from rugby to football. I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to have my own rules committee, and that way we'll know what we're doing. So Camp, the first captain, the first coach here, invented rules of the modern game today. He took care of the field. He took care of the man in motion. He took care of new plays. He was inventive. And in the end, what better way for Walter Camp to pass into the sunset than die at his own committee rules meetings? Fantastic story. Fantastic tradition. 700 and some victories when you think about Yale. More All-Americans than any other college in history. No Notre Dame for us, no Buckeye battle cry for us, no Nebraska Cornhuskers. We got it right here. Tradition, players, Heisman trophies, but more important, the ambience of this bowl. In 1888, Yale had one of its best teams ever, with Pa Corbin, Pudge Heffelfinger, and a 27-year-old divinity student by the name of Amos Alonzo Stagg. In 1891, Yale outscored its opponents by the unbelievable 478-0. On defense, the Elis were yet led by Frank Hinkey, the most feared defender in college football. Tad Jones, in 1923, he coached Yale to a 13-0 victory over Harvard in the final game to assure the Elis of a perfect season and a share of the national title. Little Albie Booth, in 1928, he carried the ball 33 times for 223 yards to lead the Elis to a come-from-behind victory over Army. In 36 and 37, Yale had two successive Heisman Trophy winners. In 1936, there was Larry Kelly, the great end. In 1937, it was Clint Frank, the Hall of Fame quarterback. In 1956, Yale won its first official Ivy League title behind running back Dennis McGill. And in the famous 1968-29-29 Harvard-Yale game, Brian Dowling scrambles all over the place and finally finds Calvin Hill in the end zone for a touchdown. In the 1974 Harvard-Yale game, quarterback Tom Doyle goes to the air with a long bomb to Gary Fensick. Between 1974 and 1981, Yale won or shared six Ivy League titles. In 1981, they were led by All-American Rich Diana, who joined Herschel Walker and Marcus Allen as All-Americans.
And by the way, you know, the Yale freshman defeated the Dartmouth freshman yesterday 40-7.
It's the second half of our re-air of Yale and Dartmouth from 1984, and we're pleased to be joined by another special guest, All-Ivy League kicker, Bill Moore. And Bill, I'll ask you the same question first that I asked your teammates. Why Yale?
Well, I applied to a bunch of schools out of high school, and frankly, Yale was the first one that said, come play for us. And so did that. Stanford called a little bit later, and I sat down with the guy in the locker room and said, hey, you know, I'm sorry, but I'm going to go to Yale because they committed to me first, so I'm going to commit to them. I'm glad I did.
When we talk with guys from your era, there is always a Carmcosa story that comes out. So is there one that you would like to share?
It's kind of funny. Carm didn't really hang out with the kickers and the punters. We were sort of a necessity that had to be in the game, and that's about all. He mostly would just call me over and say, he would just say, Billy, kick it deep, or Billy, squib it to the right, or Billy, squib it to the left, or Billy, get in there and make that extra point, and that sort of stuff like that. So he wasn't, he was fond of considering kickers to be a little bit of a screwball. And I'm not sure I appreciated that because I played on the baseball team too, but you know, the shoe fits, I guess.
Coming into this Dartmouth game, you guys were 1-2 on the season. And coming off of a really, really difficult 1983 season, was this game a turning point for your senior year?
I think so. Looking, you know, I don't have a lot of memories of it. Just it looks like I kicked 4 extra points and squibbed a few down the field. But that season was interesting because it did start out slow, like you meant. And on the heels of the 83 season, it was very, very difficult. And Marty Martinson, the captain, and some of the other leaders on the team really got the season turned around just after that. And then Dartmouth sort of cemented our belief that we could win. And I think the season kind of snowballed from there, including the HYP championships at the end of the year.
The Dartmouth game has always seemed to be a big game in the New Haven community. And there's just something about that, I guess, that perfect combination of New England fall weather, the colors of the leaves changing, and very, very competitive football.
I think the Dartmouth game was at least back then, I haven't followed it that closely lately, but was a big game. Dartmouth was always a powerhouse, and it was, you know, us and Harvard, and certainly Penn back then with the resurgence of their program. And Princeton usually had a good team as well. So Dartmouth was a measure. It was a test, and it was always good to come out on top of those guys. Has kind of proved that you had what it took to play in the Ivies that year.
Bill, we thank you for your time and really look forward to talking to you again as our re-air series continues this fall.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
That is Bill Moore, all Ivy League kicker, and we thank him very much for his insight. The 1984 Yale-Dartmouth game continues.
With men in his face, one for a touchdown, and this time really has to impress you.
To overwork a phrase, big play. Third down and 7 at the 12-yard line of Yale. Michelle in motion.
Got time.
Lots of time.
He's there.
Looking for Keir. Incomplete. Going back there was Tim Kotkevich for the Elias number 2. So it's fourth down, and Salzberger on in the field now.
With the win with him this time.
With the win with him. He attempted a 46-yarder and missed in the first quarter.
Good position by number 2, Tim Kokowitz. Time to throw. He drops back, looking the defense over. He's throwing for the end zone. He's looking for Keir, and he made sure that if Keir wasn't going to get it, Kokowitz wasn't going to get it either.
29-yard field goal attempt by Salzberger. Up and through, and it's good, and Dartmouth picks up 3 points. And the score is now Yale 14, Dartmouth 10.
This experience, it lives on our fields and in our classrooms, where every day is a test. Each moment builds on this experience and creates an environment that develops mind, body, and soul. We become part of the storied traditions of the Ivy League. This experience, it is unrivaled.
Salzgeber getting ready to kick off. We have McCauley deep. At the 10. Loose at the 30, Stewart, Mike Stewart. And driven out of bounds and hit in front of the Yale bench, and a flag is thrown in front of the Yale bench. So it'll be another. Rusty Gardner is the one who caused the infraction in front of the Yale bench out of bounds, and so Yale will pick up another 15 yards from the 29, and up around the 44.
15 yards starting your offense, 15 yards deeper in somebody else's territory. You know, you can't tell a guy that when he gives somebody a shot on the sidelines. And in some ways, you know, kids really get excited and get going on those kickoff and kickoff return teams and don't really mean it, gives a guy a shot.
Personal foul.
But in front of the other team's bench.
Hey, listen, Dartmouth likes to live dangerously.
First down Yale at the 49-yard line.
because he goes in motion. And Coase hit behind the line of scrimmage and gets it on the other side of the midfield stripe. Greg Cole making the tackle, number 8 for Dartmouth.
I'm sure that Yale is going to run out of the eye and run that power stuff until somebody stops it. And Cole, that time, number 8, came in, who is the rover, and who's really essentially almost like a linebacker, and made the play. Now that you might see them throw it.
Gained a yard on that, so it's 2nd down and 9. Let's call it midfield. Burton over the middle. Marwiti makes the reception at the 40-yard line. Andy Marwiti, 6'4", 230-pound senior out of Lake Forest, Illinois.
So you talk about a guy making adjustment on the ball. This ball is thrown low. He's got plenty of protection. Marwiti's coming across on his favorite play in behind the linebackers. You talk about a great shortstop, Sweet Lou Whitaker. How about that by Andy Marwiti, number 33?
Marwiti, a political science major at Yale. First down at the 39. Coase hits that hole very quickly and takes it to the 32-yard line. Peter Kortbein there to make the tackle. And with scores down on the sideline, Sean McDonough.
In the third quarter, Air Force continues to lead Notre Dame 14-7. Army and Rutgers are scoreless in the first quarter. Same for Alabama and Penn State. In the first quarter, it's Florida 16, Tennessee 13. Indiana and Michigan State are scoreless at halftime. We'll have more scores in just a moment.
2nd down and 2, Yale at the 32. Dave Klein on the draw, picks up the first down. Dave Klein to the 15-yard line. Greg Cole, number 8, riding him down.
Great blocking up front by Marty Martinson, number 51 and 54. This is really a fake draw where the quarterback sprints to the fullback. Finds the opening, then he breaks a couple of tackles. Klein's really a strong kid. He used to be the tailback here.
He sure was. 1st down at the 15. Yale leading by 4, 14-10. Luzzi in motion. Rick Coase gets close to the 10-yard line. Dartmouth tightens up quickly down there. Andy Osmond and Greg Cole first to hit him.
Dick, the thing that impresses me about the running backs, tailback Coase and Klein, is that they're both hard runners. They're not fancy runners. They get up into the hole very quickly. They keep their legs moving, and the line is getting off the ball. They really don't hesitate. They read that hole, and they go.
Coase with 51 yards rushing. 2nd down and 6. Line of scrimmage, the 11-yard line of Dartmouth. Klein gets the call. This time he's ridden down by Kortbein. Kortbein rides him down, but he's inside the 10 to the 7-yard line. Now with some more scores from around the country.
In the second quarter, it is Holy Cross 21, Colgate 14. Maryland rolling over North Carolina State 30-7. That is at halftime. Michigan leads Northwestern 24-0. That ball game also at the half. They're in the fourth quarter at Wisconsin. The Badgers and the Minnesota Gophers are tied 14-14. Mississippi leads Georgia 12-10. That is in the third quarter in an upset.
3rd down and 3 at the 8. Curtin keeps himself, and Curtin is going to score. Mike Curtin, from 8 yards out, has scored for Yale.
Curtin, number 7, as he goes over the sideline, jubilant, out of the I formation. He's running the option, only this time he's going to keep it off. A great block by Klein, number 35, into the end zone. He showed his quickness there and his running ability and his ability to make a decision. Great block by number 35, Dave Klein.
And Bill Moore with the extra point attempt. And once again, it is good. And Yale now leads Dartmouth 21-10.
So the field goal was important. The 7 points, the 4 points that they saved is important. We're going to take another look at this replay from the line of scrimmage. The quarterback reverse rolls, number 35, Klein, beautiful block. He keeps it into the end zone and 5. He is celebrating with everybody in the end zone. Fine play. Let's go to the Ivy League scores.
Pennsylvania with a 24-0 lead in that second period. And look at Princeton rolling over Columbia. Harvard 14-6 over Cornell. All second period scores.
Cornell's really hanging there.
Down on the sideline, Sean McDonough.
Nebraska leads Missouri 16-10. That is in the second quarter. No score yet. New Hampshire against UConn. Pitt really having their troubles. The Panthers trail South Carolina 28-14. That is in the third quarter. Baylor 17, SMU 7. That's in the third quarter. And Upton, find some offense for my Syracuse Orangemen, if you would. They trail West Virginia 13-10 in the fourth quarter.
Nothing's new with Syracuse. They just win one big game a year, Sean. That's all. The rest, they just fall asleep.
And here, the ball blows off the tee, and we'll tee it up again.
Number 7 is very happy. And why shouldn't he? It was really a great run by him, Mike Curtin. Right off the block again by Dave Klein, number 35.
And in the World Series, we have Detroit out in front of San Diego, 4-1 in the seventh inning. I know you're surprised.
Oh, yeah, really am.
We have Chambers and Duax deep, and Moore squibs it, comes down to Duax, and he drops it and then covers it wisely at the 16-yard line.
I keep saying I don't know why they don't put every kick, every ball on its side and kick it down. It might not always go into the end zone, Dick, but how many times have you seen it happen? We'll see the bobble here. Here comes the ball. It is going. He's going to get a hold of it. Give Truax a little time. He'll get it.
Here it is, the stats on the touchdown run by end drive by Mike Curtin of Yale. Dartmouth, first down at their own 16. Caraviello goes to the flat to Lorenzo Chambers. It's across that 25 to the 26. Ardell McKenna, number 56, hits him for Yale to bring him down.
Here's the danger point for Dartmouth now. Yale is now up by 10. They've slowly pulled away. They had their chance. They got a field goal instead of getting a touchdown. Now it's to a point of where they've got to really make a sustained drive, get a touchdown pretty quickly.
So it is first down and 10. Not much going there. Pick up about a yard or so. That was second down and 10. No going in there as Yale closed down quickly. Dartmouth, as you probably noticed throughout the afternoon, they alternate their fullbacks, Tom Stevenson and Rob Brown, 36 and 42. Caraviello's statistics, 16 for 23 and 156 yards passing, one touchdown. Second down and 10.
And they're all coming.
Here it comes. Oh, was he hit. Michelle makes the reception at the 35-yard line. And he's driven out of bounds by Penders. Stephen Penders, 46. But boy, did Caraviello take a hit.
Number 16, Quinn, one of the Quinn twins. I can never get them straight.
Neither can
dropping
Carposa.
Straight back. And he takes a shot from the blind side, the top of your picture. Number 16, Quinn of Yale. And I'll tell you, all you need is a couple of those, and you won't remember the next play.
8:03 left in this third quarter. Yale with a 21-10 lead here at the Yale Bowl in New Haven. A great afternoon for football. Third down and one, Dartmouth at their own 36. Dartmouth is 4 for 9 in third down conversions. Chambers gets that first down as he cracks to the 45. Jarkson makes the hit on him. McKenna is there once again. Ardell McKenna, number 56.
Dartmouth sure been able to move the football. They might not be in the end zone. Chambers really a kind of a water bug type of runner. He's getting good blocking up front. Nice block there by number 82. Good gang tackling by Yale, but he gets a lot of yardage.
Yale puts the five men up front, shows you the 5-2 on defense, and Caraviello wants to go downtown. He's looking for Truitt. Incomplete. At the 12, as Stephen Penders was going downfield step for step. Dartmouth trying desperately, Ray Holtorf, number 72, to say there was some kind of bumping and colliding going on downfield.
Well, if it could have been, it could have been on Truitt's part, who was trying to come back for the football. In fact, Penders, 46 for Yale, played that ball beautifully. Dick, he was trying to get deep on him. He saw the ball was underthrown. Truitt came back for the ball and actually, I think, interfered with Penders more than he did with him. And Penders agrees with me, right?
Who would disagree? Second down and 10 at the 45. Michelle is put out wide on the right by Dartmouth. Stevens, the lone back in the backfield. Chambers in motion to the left. This time, Caraviello goes way back. Dumps it off, looking for Chambers. Incomplete.
I'll tell you, Quinn chased him all over the field, and Quinn, since he's come in the game, has been all over the field.
He has.
Put pressure on the quarterback. He's chased down the running backs. And when you get a pressure from a guy coming from his outside position, Caraviello is now running for his life. Watch number 16, Quinn of Yale, come from the top of your picture. It gives him an extra little shove, and the ball goes nowhere.
Upton, but that time with the snap of the ball, he did start out with a deeper drop to begin the play.
Didn't do him much good,
no,
did it?
No. Third down and 10 now for Dartmouth at their own 45. Third quarter, 7:24 to play.
Pressure again.
And right into the hands of Jarkson. Jarkson intercepts for Yale and brings it back across the 40 to the 41. Scott Truitt brought him down.
Mike Jarkson made that play because of the pressure on the quarterback. Caraviello is planning to throw. Look at the pressure here. He's hit when he throws, and when you're hit when you throw, here's what happens. Number 35, Mike Jarkson, 39, Mike Jarkson, makes the interception, but that was set up because of the pressure on the quarterback.
And for a young man who's been throwing all afternoon, that was Caraviello's first interception. Yale now with the ball and a 21-10 lead. The line of scrimmage, their own 40. Mike Stewart, number 18 in the backfield now. And he brings it up across that 45 to the 47. Stewart, of course, is a, hate to say, former quarterback, because they used him at quarterback a week ago. Brought down by 81 Ed Simpson, the outside linebacker. Simpson, a business major at Dartmouth.
Look, by the way, at Joe Yukiko over the sidelines talking to Mike Caraviello, and he was hurt on that play. He's been hit pretty hard the last three or four times out. Guys got to begin to think about that.
Second down and four, Yale at their own 46. Stewart with some running room and takes it inside the Dartmouth 45 to the 43, where Scott Kehoe, the cornerback, senior out of Halifax, Massachusetts, brings him down, a business major at Dartmouth.
You can see why they moved him from quarterback to wide receiver to run a little bit of tailback, because he really does have outside speed. He's a track man. Now, it's interesting, all these quarterbacks that Koza has that plays different positions for him, but when you have versatile people like that, especially when you get a little lead, you can afford to play them.
First down, Yale again at Dartmouth's 43-yard line. The draw play this time. They're waiting for Klein, but Klein still picks up two, three hard yards. Court Vine and Quinn hit him, along with Andy Osmond for Dartmouth. He would pick up four tough yards. That would be 6 yards to go for the first down. 5:50 to play in the third quarter.
And they're controlling the football on the ground.
Kevin Moriarty out wide in the left.
Klein reading, toss to Stewart. He reads Klein's block. He sees there's nothing inside, so what's he do? A little hurdling, and he almost gets by number 37, Scott Keogh. I like this kid.
Third down two. Yale at the 35 of Dartmouth. Yale with a 21-10 lead. Klein has 10 carries for 60 yards and a touchdown for the Eli. Straight ahead, close to that first down. Everybody closed down quickly, but Hal Bork, number 58, led the charge for Dartmouth on the play.
Well, we'll see now how we're down. The defensive line of Dartmouth is getting. All Yale has to do is hold the football. They've got the lead. They're controlling the clock. They're controlling the football.
John Wolf comes in at nose guard for Dartmouth. It's fourth and one, Yale at the 34 of Dartmouth. Curtin keeps himself, but I don't believe he made it. He was going to curl off the right guard, Jerry Wozlowski, but Dartmouth closed it down quickly.
Peter Quarterbine, I think, made the tackle. If he did, he really gave him a shot in the ribs. Very important play. Maybe Peter Cornovan, number 94, comes across the line. There he's flying in the air, Curtin, but 94, Cornovan gets a shot at him. Holds holds on to the football. That could be one of the factors in turning this thing around for Dartmouth, but they've got to get some offense going, too. They've got to...
We're going to pause just a moment in our coverage of this game between the Big Green and the Bulldogs with the score Yale 21, Dartmouth 10. Yale Bowl, there's 4 minutes and 19 seconds left to play in the third quarter as Yale has an 11-point lead, and it's first down and 10 Dartmouth from their own 34-yard line. Caraviello has Dartmouth in the eye, rolls out, throws out to the flat, incomplete, looking for Chambers. Yakabuchi in there to nail Caraviello, number 55. There you see Caraviello, and there you see Yakabuchi. 4:13 to play in the third period.
You know, in the booth with us right now is Frank Ryan, the athletic director of Yale. Great quarterback. The last time I saw Frank Ryan, he beat us in the Colts 24-0, and we were just talking, and if we can a little bit later on, get the stick mic in here, we're going to talk to Frank. But Frank feels, just as we were talking, that the offensive line is owned right now, and line of scrimmage by Yale.
Second and 10, and incomplete. Intended for Keir, who has a touchdown pass reception in this game, and Carmen Alacqua out there covering on the play. He's been all over the field for the Elias defensively this afternoon, as expected, with that healthy broken hand now once recovered.
Well, when you have the lead, there's a lot of things that your defense can do that they ordinarily can't. I mean, you play a completely different game. You really are dictating with Yale with that lead, knowing that Dartmouth has to throw the football.
Third down conversions, and we have a third down and 10 for Dartmouth. They are 5 of 11 this afternoon. Chambers complete at the 40. And across midfield, and Chambers with the Dartmouth first down. McKenna hits him, and so does Patrick Maloney of Yale, number 84.
The linebacker is coming over to make the play. Watch Chambers make him miss, though. Chambers very quick when he gets to the outside. The quarterback dumps it over top of the defender. Chambers heads for the sidelines. Defender tries to catch him, but there is no way. Chambers just too quick for him.
And on this first down at the 48 of Yale, Michelle is on the other end of that reception from Caraviello, and another first down for Dartmouth. Tim Kotkevich drove him out of bounds.
They have some people that can get outside. Chambers is beginning to get there, and that last time getting by Lavaca, who really is fast and quick. If they do more of that, then they're going to get themselves to the outside.
As Dartmouth picks up the first down, we look and see 3:33 to play in this third quarter. Yale leading 21-10. Chambers has 11 carries for 48 yards for Dartmouth and 4 receptions for 33. And this first down is at the Yale 32. Chambers in motion. They go to Stevens, the fullback, and Yale recovers quickly. Keenan grabs him first, number 81, defensive right end. Picks up a couple, it'll be 8 yards forward to go for the first down, second down and 8, at the 30 of the Elias. The breeze blowing, but down on the floor of the bowl, not as brisk as it is here on the top rim. Dartmouth wide on both sides in a split backfield. Flag on the play, Caraviello goes over the middle to Burke. The pass is incomplete, intercepted by Alacqua, and there's a flag on the play from the beginning.
And they probably were hoping it was against Dartmouth, and they got the football.
I see Alacqua signaling to the sidelines holding, but we're waiting for the official call.
That's right. So it'd been a fumble, it would have been Yale's ball.
Well, they ruled that Burke did not have possession, and it's an incompleted pass and holding on the play. Penalty yardage being marked off now. 2:47 to go in this third quarter.
Here we've got the holding call. Why is it when you make a completion, it's very important you get called for holding? Of course, you know, Dartmouth today, Dick, are dropping back. They're not rolling a lot away from the pressure. And when you're doing that and people are sending people from the outside, then you're going to get caught for holding.
This time they put Truett out wide with Michelle in a slot. So it's second down and 18. Out to the flat, Stevens. Stevens, the fullback, to the 35. Brought down by Alakwa and Jarkson.
Joining us in the booth, we've got now somebody who can really help us call the game as we watch Caraviello drop it off here to Stevens, number 36. He doesn't go too far. All right, Frank, call the game for us the rest of the way. We're going to retire.
Frank Ryan, of course, who Upton is speaking about, the athletic director at Yale University. We'll get to Frank after this play. Third down and 12 from the 34 of the Elias. And here the rush. Zanieski makes the sack, and there's a flag on the play back at the 40-yard line. Caraviello sacked by Zanieski, flag at the 40.
Which probably means holding on top of it. We're going to see it on the replay. He's dropping straight back. He's getting some pressure, but here he comes, 69 Zanieski, to wrap him up. And holding on top of it. Boy, you talk about being insulted. Frank, you've been in that position before. Not being insulted, but being hit by somebody.
Well, that's right. There was a real nice blitz there. It wasn't just John Zanieski, of course. It was a couple of Yale linebackers, Ardell McKenna, and I believe John Quinn, that was bearing down on him. That's enough to terrify any quarterback.
Frank, you think we talked to Yale yesterday, and they said they had to contain Caraviello. They just had to keep from getting around that perimeter himself, and Eli defense has done that this afternoon as Owen Field punts on this fourth down and into the end zone to be brought out to the 20-yard line.
Well, that's true. They've got a very dangerous pass offense, but if you can make the quarterback hesitate, you've gone a long ways to stopping them.
Are you surprised at all, Frank, that Caraviello has not rolled more away from the pressure? As you say, you're sending your outside people, putting tremendous pressure on him. He's dropping straight back in a pocket. Does it make it easier for the defenders?
Well, in a way, of course, the lineman can tee off and rush him a little bit more easily. But on the other hand, the pass pattern downfield puts more pressure on the defensive secondary.
Yale with the football once again from their own 20 with an 11-point lead, 21-10 here in the third quarter with a minute and 48 seconds remaining. And I believe Curtin might have taken a little bit too much time executing that play as flags are dropped.
Somebody might have been in motion too, maybe the left side of the line.
You're right.
On the offense.
Illegal procedure.
Frank, what about Curtin? You know, a lot of people don't know a lot about him, but I know he's been injured off and on. What about Curtin?
Curtin is a very fine athlete who has had some injuries, and the offense has never really gelled either last year or this year, but maybe we're seeing it come together today.
Yale now with a first down and 15. Line of scrimmage, their own 15-yard line. Rick Coase gets the call up the middle. He goes to the 20. Al Bork, the nose guard for Dartmouth, in there to close down quickly. Senior from Westfield, New Jersey. And you see today's attendance. Good crowd on a beautiful fall afternoon. Yale with a second down and 9 as they picked up 6 on the last play. Kevin Moriarty out wide on the right. Yale lines up in the eye. Curtin heads for the sidelines and out of bounds as he finds nothing going downfield. Andy Osmond, 91, putting the pressure on, and Keogh covering on the play.
Well, the reason that happened is there is good coverage here, really fine coverage. In fact, the real coverage is he's down on the ground. That's the best coverage ever.
That's true. And of course, when the quarterback's rolling to the short side of the field as he was, there's not a lot of territory downfield to work with, and he usually has one option, and if it's not there, then you've got to run it out of bounds and throw it away.
Third down 11 now for Yale at their own 19. This is only the 10th pass of the ball game, and it's off the hands of Andy Marwiti at the 35-yard line.
Frank, if you could quickly explain the difference in the hash marks and the field, the way it's set up in the college versus the pros, because it does dictate a strategy a lot differently.
That's true. The hash marks are, as I understand it, wider apart in the college game than in the professional game. And consequently, when your team is lined up on one hash mark or the other, the long side of the field is awfully long and the short side is awfully short. And defenses play that. They really do.
There's really more strategy because of the way it's set up.
Absolutely. I was disappointed when the pros moved the hash marks in because it made the game very uniform.
Hank Eaton punting for Yale. This is his third punt of the afternoon. 42-yard punt. And returned to the 44-yard line. Is the downfield covered by Yale? Good on the play. McKenna down there quickly.
Frank is a quarterback, and again, in Ivy League football, anything can happen. We've seen games turn around, as you did here last year against Dartmouth. When does the clock begin to become a factor when you feel a team's dominating another? Are we about to that point yet?
I don't think so. I think Dartmouth is still very much into the game. They need one score to make it a very contentious situation.
Caraviello has passed 32 times, make it 33. Out in the flat to Lorenzo Chambers. Chambers takes it into Yale territory to the 47. McKenna and Penders over there very quickly, along with Keenan, and also Doug Millett in the lineup.
That's one way to take the pressure off, huh, Frank?
Absolutely. I'm very impressed with Dartmouth's pass offense. They do a lot of things. They have a good variety, and they've got some good skill people. They're always a threat. Of course, that's what brought them back to beat us in the last minutes of the game last year.
13 seconds in the clock running here in the third quarter. Second down and one, Dartmouth at the 47. Fumble in the backfield. Did Dartmouth cover? Yes, they did. Picks up on the handoff.
It was, but Zanieski beat his man right across the line of scrimmage.
And at the end of the quarter, the score is Yale 21, Dartmouth 10. And here's a message of special interest.
You can make it if you try. You can make it if you try. You can make it if you try. Oh, yeah.
Giving money, what about to the Ivy League football game of the week? Where else can you get Frank Ryan in person to call the play-by-play of the color, too?
Ardell McKenna bats that pass down as Caraviello wants to throw on the first play of the fourth quarter. Now Dartmouth once again faced with that fourth down situation, punting situation, as the Yale defense just closes it down. And the man who electrified this crowd earlier in the ball game, number 26 for Yale, standing back there in single safety around the 11-yard line, Ted McCauley, who has a 71-yard touchdown scamper today as Field gets off a beautiful punt for Dartmouth, and McCauley takes it at the 5. And the going gets tough, as they say, and he's down at the 15.
Frank, again, going back to Dartmouth while we have the change of possession. Caraviello knows essentially he's got to throw the football to get back in this game. As a quarterback, what does it really do? It really takes away the weapon of the running game. What do you do? I mean, how do you mix it?
Well, there's not a lot you can do. The defense more and more is looking for the pass. You've got an option on draw. You've got an option on a screen pass, and I know that Dartmouth has got that in their repertoire. In fact, they've done it today a couple of times already, and with some success. So they'll mix it in, but after all, they've got to get the ball downfield, and they've got to do it successfully.
Yeah, well, the first down at the 15-yard line. Flag on the play. Bork makes the stop. Spivak in the lineup for the first time this afternoon for Yale, number 43, the ball carrier. Here in the first minute of play in the fourth quarter, Yale with its 11-point lead, 21-10.
What are you trying to do now if you're Courtney? Trying to control the football, just hold on,
well,
run
to I think
off the
that,
clock?
That Yale needs a nice sustained drive here. It takes up some time. It'll
have a 5-yard penalty, 5-yard penalty, personal foul, grabbing the face mask, first down.
Hopefully we'll eat up some time and get some points too. That would really put Dartmouth with their backs to the wall if we could manage that.
First down and 6 for Yale at the 19, their own, and Curtin goes straight ahead. Trying to get it on his own, crossed to the 24-yard line as Andy Osmond is there, the defensive right tackle, 91. And with some more scores from around the country, Sean McDonough.
Gentlemen, some final scores starting to trickle in from around the country. Syracuse has gone down to defeat this afternoon at Morgantown, West Virginia. The Mountaineers winning 20-10. And Lou Holtz has a victory for Minnesota. The Golden Gophers beat Wisconsin 17-14.
And here at the Yale Bowl, Yale has a second down and 1 at their own 24 in the fourth quarter. McCauley again as he breaks out to the 35-yard line. Andy Osmond ankle tackles him to bring him down, or else it would have been bye-bye again.
So think, Frank, we were talking about all your tailbacks, and we're going to see McCauley here busted up out of the I formation, right behind the lead block. Look at that hole, the way he goes right through it. All your tailbacks seem to hit that hole very quickly.
Well, they do, and of course, it looks like good old-fashioned single-wing football to me. It's a very powerful off-tackle slant.
On the 36, and Yale goes off the left guard slot, picks up a couple, and even a couple more as they get out to the 40-yard line. Bork in there along with Kortbein, combining for the stop. McCauley has 3 carries and 85 yards rushing in the ball game, 71 of them coming on that touchdown run in the second quarter. In penalties this afternoon, Yale's been penalized 8 times for 60 yards, and Dartmouth 5 times for 50.
Sounds like Curtin's listening to you, Frank. He's doing exactly what you told him to do.
Well, it's Seb Laspina calling the plays, but Seb's an awfully, awfully intelligent play selector, so.
Second down and 6 now for the Elias from the 40. Spivak gets the call. He's going to go down behind the line of scrimmage as Dartmouth's defense penetrates. Lou Fontes again on the stop. He's been a solid performer for Dartmouth today on defense. Fontes, they say, is the strongest of the people on the Dartmouth football team.
And probably one of the smallest.
And Yale will not forget him a year ago because he had 19 tackles in the Yale game last season in the bowl. Maybe Frank will tell us why in our audience. We know why, but tell our audience why Dartmouth is playing in New Haven 2 years in a row. There's a definite reason for that. We'll ask him after this play. Third down and 8, Yale from their own 38. Complete to the 45-yard line. Pomeroy makes the tackle.
Well, you know, Dick, it was really Dartmouth's choice to do that. They had a situation in which they played Yale and Harvard either at home both games in a given year or away, and they wanted to split that up. So they had to adjust their schedule and decided to do it with us by playing us down here twice, and now this puts them on a rotation where they'll play either Harvard or Yale at home each year.
There you see some league scores. Pennsylvania in front of Brown in the third period. Wadley and Princeton rolling over Columbia. 31-8 in the third. First down here for Yale.
Nice completion, by the way, from Curtin to Mark Quinlan, who's been hurt, number 14, a tight end. That now gives Yale 2 really good tight ends. And I've been really impressed with 33, Andy Marwee. He's a big receiver and a terrific target.
Yale just trying to consume as much time as they can off that clock, as we pointed out, as they have the 11-point lead. Curtin goes out to the flat, in and out of the hands of Dave Klein. He started to run before it got there.
He did, and there were 2 defensive linemen, one being number 91, Andy Osmond, who would have loved to have had a lineman's dream and gotten a hold of the football.
First downs this afternoon. Dartmouth has 19, Yale 14, with 11:34 to go in this fourth quarter. Yale with a second down and 10 from their own 46. Through 3 quarters, Dartmouth had 214 yards passing to Yale's 47, and Yale had 219 yards rushing to Dartmouth's 39. Curtin looking for Luzzi, but Greg Cole had him covered at the 45-yard line, and the pass goes incomplete. Curtin, 6 for 13, 54 yards passing.
Frank, as a guy who's played pro football, college athletic director Frank Ryan here at Yale, the question comes about college quarterbacks and whether they should call their own plays or whether the coach should call it. I've always been against it in the pros and in some cases maybe in the colleges. How do you feel about it?
Well, I'm a great believer in the quarterback calling their own plays. You get a sense of how the game is going, and there's a bit of emotion out there on the field that comes into play. People on the sidelines don't always have that same feeling.
Third down play now for Yale from their own 46. Curtin's got time, and over the middle, wide open is Luzzi. Luzzi has room. And Luzzi driven out of bounds at the 20-yard line by Peter Wade, the last man between him and the goal line. They say he went out at the 21.
Well, he was really wide open in the middle of the zone. Nice drop back by Curtin. He gets set up beautifully over the top. You can see that ball is drilled in right behind the linebacker, and I mean, that really has to be a perfect... How about you?
Yard reception for Luzzi, who is Yale's leading receiver coming into this ball game. McCauley can't find much running room. He's down at the 18-yard line as Andy Osmond, number 91, takes him down. Coming into the ball game today, Luzzi had 10 receptions, averaging 11 yards per reception and one touchdown.
You know, getting back to Curtin, the quarterback, he has a funny motion. You look at him throw in practice, say there's no way this guy can deliver the football. It looks so exaggerated, his motion.
That motion comes from throwing the ball a lot on the roll. And you get it from throwing while you're running.
Second down, 8 from the 19 of Dartmouth. Yale on the move. Curtin looks for Kevin Moriarty, but incomplete. A little mistiming there on both parts. Carson and Pomeroy covering on the play. And third down conversions, the Elis of Yale this afternoon have been successful 7 of 11 attempts.
Well, you're now down here and you're the quarterback, Frank Ryan. You don't want to take yourself out of the position for the field goal if you can, and maybe seal it up, so call the play.
Well, I think I would try an individual route to either wide receiver. We've got Moriarty out there isolated on this fella. I would let the skill of Moriarty come to work on this.
Here comes a blitz.
Over the middle, and it is complete to Quinlivan. Mark Quinlivan picks up the first down, and it'll be first and goal to go from the 8-yard line. Pomeroy, the captain of Dartmouth, made the tackle, but not before the completion and the first down had been made.
Here's why I think college quarterbacks someday ought to get paid. Watch 81 Ed Simpson right in his face, right in Curtin's face as he makes the throw, Frank, to the tight end, who's got a man, Quinlivan, right on him. Great throw, great catch.
A lot of courage, a lot of concentration on doing his job, and he did it well.
First and goal to go from the 7 for Yale. Luzzi in motion to the left. Dave Klein up the middle to the 5-yard line, picks up a tough 2. Curtin has put the ball up 16 times, completed 8 for 50% average, 98 yards. Yale leads 21-10 if you've just joined us with 9:53 to play in the fourth quarter from the Yale Bowl in New Haven. Mike Curtin, when we talked to him yesterday, was a very positive young man about how Yale's football team has now come together. And with everybody back, there was a very positive attitude. And in no way did they think they were going to lose this football game today. Second down and goal to go from the 4. And into the end zone is McCauley. That's Ted McCauley with his second touchdown of the day for Yale.
Just went in behind the right side of the line. They've moved their people back. He gets into the hole quickly, but look at the way the offensive line comes off the ball. Really, there's only a little bit of penetration by the Dartmouth defense, but he carries a few people in the end zone with him. That really impresses me. He's not that big a runner.
But he's only 5'10", 184 pounds.
Well, he's got a nose for the goal line, I'll tell you that.
He's got a pretty good line in front of him, too.
Bill Moore now attempting the extra point. Bill's only missed one this season. He is successful again, and Yale has now taken a 28-10 lead over Dartmouth.
We'll take another look at Mr. McCauley from a lower angle to get an idea of how you knock linemen off. He has really picked up there. That's one way to get hurt when you come down and somebody comes down on top of you and knocks the wind out of you. But he got into the end zone, and the right side of the line did their job.
This experience, it lives on our fields and in our classrooms, where every day is a test. Each moment builds on this experience and creates an environment that develops mind, body, and soul. We become part of the storied traditions of the Ivy League. This experience, it is unrivaled.
Now Dartmouth is in the unenviable position of throwing all the time, every time.
Well, and Yale accomplished what they needed to accomplish, which was to get some points and also take some time off the scoreboard.
Yale's also accomplishing something else around the league this afternoon as people poke in from other Ivy League cities, and that is to make other Ivy League coaches very, very nervous as they know that Yale has able to put an offense together along with the defense, and that shows concern for the rest of their schedule.
Maybe 30,000 more people will go to the Harvard-Yale game.
and the game at Penn. Here's the kickoff to Lorenzo Chambers, who picks it up with the three. Chambers with a nice return to the 25-yard line. John Shannon brought him down.
Ted McCauley, not a bad day. 5 carries, 92 yards, 2 touchdowns. He's a little happy. We still got to go back to class on Monday.
And if you're a sophomore, you're just twice as happy. The drive consumed 5 minutes and 14 seconds. Yale moved 85 yards in 13 plays. McCauley going in from 4 yards out. .923 left to play. Mike Caraviello has quarterbacked all the way for Dartmouth. Dartmouth, of course, playing today without Rich Weissman. They're all everything back. Chambers can't hang on. An incompleted pass. And the reason that Alakwa and everybody continued to play was why, Upton?
Because sometimes it can be a fumble.
That's right. Sometimes it could be called
here
a fumble.
We'll watch Mr. Lorenzo Chambers. He's supposed to be circling out on a little draw, but the pressure from 55 of Yale was quite too much, and the pressure in his hands were too much. He dropped the ball.
We have a second down and 10 for Dartmouth from their own 24-yard line. 9:17 to play in the game. This will be the 36th pass attempt of the day by Caraviello. It's complete to Doug Keir, and he fights for and probably gets that first down at the 34-yard line. John Quinn riding him down for Yale.
Frank, the poise of a quarterback being behind by this score at this time, certainly hoping to get back in the game, but you've been in that situation before. How difficult is it? What do you have to do with your own ball club to control their poise?
Well, that club needs some accomplishment on the field. They've got to move the ball. They've got to have a sense they can move the ball, and right now, this is a very crucial down.
Third down and 2 it is for Dartmouth from their own 33. Lorenzo Chambers gets the first down and takes it up close to the 40-yard line.
Upton, a question for you. I am curious as to your opinion about the absence of Rich Weissman and what effect that had on the ball game. It seems, from my vantage point, that Dartmouth really has made no attempt to establish the running game, and perhaps if he were in the lineup, they would have concentrated more on the run. We've given the very lopsided statistics, passing versus the run for Dartmouth. What's your comment on that?
Well, first of all, we're going to rip up your contract and give you a new one because you hit it right on the nose. Actually, we said at the top of the game, without Weissman, there's a lot of things that they could not do. Losing that combination of yardage in running and passing, I just think was too much for Dartmouth.
Caraviello just completed that pass to Jeff Michelle, at the Yale 48-yard line.
Does it mean more, Dick and Frank, in a college football game than, say, in a pro game, to lose a guy like Weissman who does so much for a team?
My opinion is that it's the case, because an athlete like that contributes a lot, and you become very dependent upon a very strong contributor on your team.
First down, Dartmouth at the Yale 48. Complete again to Jeff Michelle, and he steps out of bounds at the Yale 34-yard line. That's his sixth reception, Michelle, on the afternoon.
I'll tell you, Chambers is hurt, too. I don't know if Chambers pulled a muscle. He's going off the field now. Notice also the quarterback is beginning, Caraviello, to roll a little bit more away from that pressure.
Well, that's of course, a smart reaction because Yale's defensive line has really been putting the pressure on him. I'm interested in the fact that they're spreading their passes out to both sides of the field, too.
First down at the Yale 34. There's Michelle one-on-one with Kutkevich, and the ball comes up short, however.
Well, that was, again, good pressure by John Zanieski. That's half of good pass defense.
That's right, because he had him isolated. He had him man for man, yep. And he probably could have completed it if he had time.
Second down at the 34 of Yale. Stevens goes to the sideline, and checking in is Rob Brown. The fullbacks alternate all day long for Dartmouth. That's their the backs that rotate bring in the plays. They use the fullback position. 7:38 to play in the football game. Yale leading 28-10.
They're all coming.
Looking for picked off by Kotkevich. He may go all the way. Kotkevich has only Rob Brown to beat, and the block was thrown by Alakwa, and he goes down and fumbles in the end zone.
Oh! And Dartmouth recovers.
And Dartmouth recovers. If he stayed out to the sideline, he's in. He cut it back.
Number 65, the center, Saylor, recovered the ball in the end zone after Kutkevich takes it all the way in for a touchdown. Now, you talk about a crazy play. Here's the interception. He steps right in front. He's going down the sidelines. The coaches are helping him down the sideline, Frank, all the way.
All he had to do was stay straight.
Yeah. Just straight. Don't cut right. Back. Don't cut back. But he does cut back. Now he hesitates. He sees that end zone, he gets pushed from the back, out comes the ball, and you'll see 65, Bob Saylor, the center, jump in and recover it.
That's just incredible. What a change of events there.
Oh, he is broken up on it, and I don't blame him. He makes a great play. He really anticipated and stepped right in front to make that reception.
Watch the standing O he'll get. Watch. Just look at his crowd.
This is the pro game, they'd be booing him.
Well, he did make a great play.
That's right, he did make it. If they were in Municipal Stadium in Cleveland or in Boston, they'd all be booing.
Well, Dartmouth back at the 20-yard line. Well, with 7:18 to play.
It's got to give Caraviello a couple of second thoughts now about putting the ball down the field.
Especially with that pressure that he got, because Michelle was open, but he stepped right in front of him.
That was a 66-yard return until the fumble. Chambers, Lorenzo Chambers. Jarkson rides him out of bounds for Yale inside the midfield stripe about the 47-yard. No, they say he stepped out at the 48 of Dartmouth.
That was really a good call. This is the way to take the pressure off the rush. Drop it out to Chambers. Chambers uses his blockers beautifully. He really has good speed. Heads for the sidelines.
.708 to play in the football game here at the Bowl.
One thing you don't want to do is let another team back in the game after you think you have them down.
First down at the 48. Caraviello and Chambers drops it again. Mike Caraviello has tied Dartmouth's single-game completion record of 25, set by Kevin Case versus Brown in 1976.
I'll tell you, somebody who has really played a great game for Yale today has really put tremendous pressure on. Maybe we ought to mention a little bit more Dean Yakabuchi, number 55. He's put tremendous pressure on from the outside. He's not a very big kid,
but he's quick. And that's characteristic of Yale defense. Good, quick line.
Second and 10 now. Hanging on at the 39-yard line. Steve Penders makes the hit. Scott Truitt made the reception, number 89, who has been the favorite target of Caraviello this afternoon.
Now the clock really becomes a factor. He's got to move that ball down there quickly, get a couple scores. He's got to get this one first, though, before he can think about anything.
And there's not a lot of time when you're down 18 points, I must say.
6:42 to go. Quinn comes in, but he gets away from that. Complete to Rob Brown. And Brown goes down at the 39 as Rush brings him down. Tony Rush, a senior out of Lafayette Hills, Pennsylvania, majoring in economics at Yale.
That was a case of trying to get the pressure off, and he still couldn't do anything about it. This is Bob Brown, fullback. He catches the ball, but the Yale defenders, this is another example you're talking about, Yale's quickness. That was really almost a screen pass, or getting it out to the flat, and they were still out there with it.
Second and 12, as now Caraviello owns that single game passing record of completions. And he just keeps adding to it as he hits Burke there on the sidelines. And Burke goes out of bounds at the Yale 35, driven out by Bob Keenan. 5:56 to play. Next week, Yale takes on Columbia. There you see the time left in this ball game.
I'm really impressed with Caraviello. He's kept his poise. You know, they're down by over two touchdowns. He's still brought them down the field each time he's had the ball.
He has. He's done a good job.
Third down and 7 now for Caraviello from the 35.
Oh.
Here comes pursuit, and he goes down as your man, Iacobucci, comes in there, number 55, to sack him back, Dean Iacobucci. Be sure and be with us for next week's Ivy League Game of the Week. And that schedule, of course, includes games between Brown at Cornell, Columbia at Yale, Harvard at Dartmouth. That's at 1 p.m. next Saturday, October 20th, on these Eastern Educational Network stations. And Adam, as Dartmouth gets prepared to punt, Elwin Fields gets it away. McCauley takes it and returns. And talking about next week's activity, I don't know, I'm still leaning toward that Cornell game up at Ithaca, Upton.
That's just because it's fall foliage time up there. You want to go up there. We all like to go up there at that time of year. You going to pick me up and take me up?
Well, I kind of thought maybe you'd drive down from Boston and pick me up.
I got to find a private plane and go up there. See if somebody can take us up there. Yeah, and we have plenty of foliage of our own here to look at
just
this.
Just look at that. That's the scene from the Yale Bowl as we look out at top in the direction of East and West Rock in New Haven. And just a beautiful sight at this time of the year. Yale now with the football once again from their own 19-yard line.
Just control the football. Frankly, while assuming that Yale is going to win this game, what about the way your club has come along in the last three games? There are a lot of people that really felt this was going to be a bad Yale team, and I don't think you feel that way. I think you think
well,
you're turning it around.
That's right. Yale has a lot of fine athletes. They've gone through a very poor year last year, and they need to believe in themselves. And this sort of victory, if we can sustain it, is exactly what the doctor ordered.
Second down and 6 from the 23. Bobble in the backfield, and who
Dartmouth
recovers? And does Dartmouth come up with the football? Their players seem to be the most jubilant. Dartmouth has recovered the football as Coase couldn't keep the handle, and it was Bork who pounced on it, number 58 for Dartmouth.
Also, Kevin Quinn was in on that, and I think it was Rick Coase that had the ball, and he lost it.
We had a new quarterback in there, which we didn't notice at number 11, Mike Sear, came into the lineup for the first time.
Here's the toss to Coase. He never really had control of the football, and he falls down. The ball falls in front of him. Dartmouth recovers. Watch 77 come on top of the pile. Kevin Quinn of Dartmouth. Here we go again.
Dartmouth with the ball on the 22-yard line of Yale. Caraviello to whom Chambers this time hangs on and gets good yardage and goes down deep in the Yale territory to the 10-yard line. McKenna bringing him down. Yale has sacked Caraviello 4 times for 45 yards this afternoon. Scores around the league. Pennsylvania adds to that margin over Brown. Princeton over Columbia by a wide margin. And Harvard putting it to Cornell in the fourth period.
Yeah, we did Penn last week, and we were so impressed, Frank, with Penn. I mean, they looked so strong. And we had done Princeton the week before, barely eked out a win over Bucknell. And Princeton is beating Columbia as bad as Penn did last week.
Well, both teams, Princeton and Pennsylvania, are going to be contenders this year, I'm sure.
First down, goal to go from the 10. Dartmouth with the football. They trail 28-10. Caraviello looking for Keir, and it's overthrown. Doug Keir, who has one touchdown reception this afternoon.
It looked like Keir came across, and I'm sure Caraviello is disappointed. He's set up, and he's throwing to the left corner of the end zone. This is almost, I mean, you know, if the ball had been a little closer, been a touchdown, this is almost the same play that they scored on at the end of the first half. To Keir in the right side of this end zone.
Yep. Second down and goal to go from the 10 for Dartmouth. They trail 28-10. A year ago at this time, I'll tell you about that. It is about the same point in the ball game. And tackling from behind, Carmen Alacqua. Carmen Alacqua, number 40, sacks Caraviello for the fifth time this afternoon.
That's one of the things. It's got to be tough. We'll see a Lockwood number 40 come from the bottom of your screen. Pass protection. The back steps up, but nobody picks up a Lockwood on this type of offensive formation, Frank. And really, you're exposed to that type of blitzing from the outside.
That's right. I'm not sure. It probably was a missed assignment because he shouldn't have gotten in there quite that cleanly.
The back picked up the first man, and a Lockwood came right off his tail, right by him. There was nobody there.
Third and goal to go from the 18 down. Yale has five sacks on Caraviello for minus 53 yards in this football game. 3:25 to play. Chambers in motion for Dartmouth. Caraviello's got a lot of room to run. Keenan drives him down at the four-yard line. Bob Keenan. But it'll be fourth down coming up and goal to go.
Really a fine scramble here. He's got time to throw. He's got pretty good protection. He looks to his left. Good coverage by Yale, and he takes off, which a good quarterback's going to do. Slide. Don't get hit, slide.
Caraviello has exceeded the 300-yard passing mark this afternoon with 29 completions out of 47 attempts, one touchdown, two interceptions.
Well, the clock is ticking down, and the only reason you say that there's always a chance is the two-point conversion.
While we have some time, Upton, let's review that schedule next week. Let's take a good look at it. All right, Harvard's at Dartmouth, Brown's at Cornell, Columbia's here at Yale, Princeton and Navy and Penn and Army. Those are non-league games. So the features will be Harvard at Dartmouth, Brown at Cornell. What do you like?
Well, Frank said Upton say Columbia at Yale. But no, I'm not going to say that. I want to go up to Cornell. I have. But Frank, what do you think?
What do you like there, Frank?
Well, I tell you, Brown's getting beat badly today, but that only means they're going to come back tougher next week. And Cornell is another team that's, I think, about to emerge. Of course, Harvard is always Harvard, and they've got to pick up defeated Dartmouth team from today's game, and that could be a tough one also.
So what Frank is really saying is we're going to Cornell.
I think so. I'm getting my winter coat out. I know that when I get home today. Okay, big play now for Dartmouth. It's fourth and goal to go from the four-yard line of Yale. Dartmouth trails 28-10 with 3:11 to play in the game. Caraviello has been magnificent and throws a touchdown to Scott Truitt. Scott Truitt gets Dartmouth on the scoreboard one more time.
Right in front of Penders, number 46. A heck of a call.
Well, you've got to give Dartmouth credit. They've really kept coming back. And I can only think back to last year when they came back and prevailed.
That's what I was just going to mention a year ago. They did it with 47 seconds.
Yeah. Here he is. He has it right in the top of the end zone, right in front of Penders. Fine throw. Scott Truitt, number 89, and naturally they're going to go for the two-point. What are they going to do here, Frank? Go to the wide outs, to the wide side of the field?
Well, I think it'll probably roll to one side or the other. Well, no, there I go again.
Right over that middle and wide open, and it's complete. And that's Frank Doyle, who made the reception for the 2 points. And it is 28-18, Yale in front with 3:05 to play.
Only 10 points down again, and Frank Ryan, boy, I tell you something, he's nervous again.
Well, any of us who were here a year ago would be nervous in that sense if you saw that game. Yale had a 21-3 lead at the half, and with 47 seconds left to play in the football game, Pulcinello hit Mike McCaro with a pass, and that gave Dartmouth the victory.
In this case, that was really, again, a fine call. He sent motion to the wide side of the field. He had a guy cut inside and hit the tight end.
Well, their offense spread our defense out pretty nicely on the goal line there, and there are a lot of holes in there.
The onside kick it, naturally. You think? Onside kick?
Well, it looks like our team's prepared for it. If it comes, it's sort of a dangerous call because it would give us good field position if we were able to...
Maybe end the game, too. Yeah, hold the football. I might kick it deep, take my chance, play defense, see if I can get it back. But they're not going to listen to me.
Bounces all over the place.
They got it.
I don't know. It looks like they might have it.
But did the ball go 10 yards?
That's the question.
I believe they touched it before it went 10
yards. I think you're right, Frank. Yep.
48, Zoldy was the guy that made the recover.
By the kicking team. It's first down.
All right.
Here we go. Everybody is going to the left side of the field. Look at this. This is fun. Off the side of his foot. Well, they kick the ball before it goes 10 yards.
We have a new quarterback, number 11, Mike Shear, the senior for Yale. Draw play goes to Chip Bonney. Bonney gets out to about the 41. Linfontis making the stop for Dartmouth. You have Coase and Bonney in the backfield for Yale. 31 and 41. Coase, a junior, majoring in economics. Second down and four, and they picked up six on that previous play. Line of scrimmage, the 41. Rick Coase picks up a couple, but he's short of that first down as Bork is in there to make the initial hit.
Frank's no longer pale. He looks human again after that to get the ball back.
Well, I tell you, this is a big down. I'd hate to give the ball back to Dartmouth because they're a threatening team. They've proven they can move it a long ways.
Run it down close enough even for a field goal if you had to.
This young man can throw the football too, Mike Shear. 2:02 to play. Third down and one. Coase gets the call. Coase spins down at the 25 as he is brought down by Dan Carson.
That's always the danger when you're up close, Frank, and a guy just breaks it. They're all up close. Instead of running inside, they take it outside. There was a big hole for Coase. When there's a big hole for him, he's gone. That might be the game right there.
Upton, we have a...
It was a bad play.
Minute and 35 to play. Yale with a first down at the Dartmouth 25. And Bonney gets inside the 20 to 17-yard line. Carson makes the stop. A minute 23 to play in the football game as Bonney goes back to the huddle. Timeouts left in the game. Yale has three. Dartmouth has two. Eli's have a second down and two from the 18-yard line of Dartmouth. Shea in the lineup. He's out there wide on the left side for Yale, number six. Coase tries the middle.
They might be able to run it out without ever having to kick or anything else, and that might be the best thing in light of the quarterback for Dartmouth.
That's right.
You're going to have two shots to make this yard, so it's third down and a short yard for the first down. At the 16-yard line, 40 seconds to play. Maybe they won't even get another play off.
Dick, I'd say this has been a very fine football game, and I really want to thank you guys for being here and giving us this excellent telecast. It's great for Abbey football to have you guys with us.
We thank you, and I'll tell you, it's nice to be invited. Frank Ryan, the athletic director at Yale University. Inside the 10, and that'll probably do it as Bonas makes the stop, and Bonney the ball carrier.
But the clock stops
at 16 seconds.
Sear with a straight handoff. Look at the hole. You know, you said when you walked in here, Frank Ryan, that you were controlling the ball at the line of scrimmage both ways, and you were right, because that is where it has been won.
That's really been the secret to Yale's success today, as their line has done an awfully good job with the Dartmouth line.
Chip Bonney gets the call, and that runs down the clock. That is the end of the football game. Yale has won its second consecutive football game, and they have beaten Dartmouth 28-18, even up their Ivy League record at 1-1. Dartmouth goes 0-4 and 0-2 in Ivy League play.
Well, it is a big win for Yale, and now you're really back in the race again.
I think we're back in the race, and I think our team has found itself. They've got a lot to believe in, and we're looking forward to the rest of the season. It's going to be a very interesting Ivy race this year, I believe.
Well, we thank you for coming in here, Frank, and of course, we expect you to be wherever we are next week. Pick up the call with us and do it again.
Well, if you'll come down and show our Yale-Columbia game, we'll be glad to do it again.
We'll be very happy to do it. Thank you.
It's been my pleasure. Thank you.
Thank you very much.